All right. I'd like to call the regular Board of Education meeting to order for on Monday, February 10th. Please rise for the pledge.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic of which stands one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Roll call, Kelly.
Ms. Butterbit?
Here.
Mr. Casalea?
Here.
Ms. Flynn?
Excuse.
Mr. Rakowski?
Here.
Ms. Stadler?
Here.
Mr. Singh?
Here.
Mr. Wolf?
Here.
Ms. Huer?
Here.
Mr. White?
Here. Fire assistant Matt?
Exits are in the back of the LGI.
All right, we have open to the public. Would anybody like to address the board? Seeing none, we're going to move to the first workshop and we're going to start with facilities. Anthony.
Thanks, guys. Good evening. I like to start off every year with some of the previous year accomplishments. So some 2019 accomplishments. One of the things that we've really been working on is improvements in playgrounds. We're really lucky to have some great PTO, PTA groups that have invested in the students and worked with the facilities department to improve on the playground. So a lot of times what happens is PTO will purchase playground equipment and the district facilities department will work to install. So here we have some installed playgrounds at JVF, PTO purchased. We've installed a Gaga pit at Sargent Elementary School with the help of some teacher volunteers. We've installed playground equipment at Sargent as well, purchased by PTO.
I'm sorry, what's a Gaga pit?
We'll get to the picture, it'll be a little bit better, easier to explain. It's a good question though. And we also plan, actually this week, we're going to try to get the Gaga pit installed at Glenham that was also purchased by Glenham PTO. Excuse me. Some site work improvements. The big one is we paved the entire back playground area at South Avenue Elementary. Some aesthetic and function upgrades. We continue to install classroom by classroom cubbies at Glenham. Basketball backboards and assemblies were installed at South Avenue, as well as new treads and risers on the gym stairs. excuse me. And gym floor resurfacing was done at the high school and at South Avenue. So equipment purchases this year. We purchased temporary press box and some bleachers for the new turf field. Also purchased some new cleaning and disinfecting equipment, which has been very useful during this flu season. So sustainability review. Some sustainability beginnings. So we worked with two community members, Jeff Demansky as well as Anna Sullivan, together with NYSERDA, in benchmarking the district's energy use. We also worked with Jeff and Anna to interview on-site energy management managers as part of a NYSERDA program. And here in the high school and some other schools throughout the district, we also, the custodial staff assisted in food service reusable tray initiative. So areas of focus and sustainability, continued a focus on recycling, as well as coordinating areas of sustainability with the new A&E firm BBS for the upcoming capital project.
I have a question.
Sure.
What does an energy manager do?
That's a very good question. They would actually be on site a good portion of the time. They could work from home, but they would be working to see where we can, where the district could cut energy costs or how we can implement more sustainable energy. And it would they would work with the district solely.
They review data constantly. They train our people to, you know, set the controls the proper way, work really closely with the person would work really closely with Anthony. And the way it works is NYSERDA covers, if we would get it, NYSERDA would pay for 75% of the person's salary.
Yes.
So it's kind of a cool program. And one of the groups we looked at, it's not just a person, it's sort of like a firm, right? You know, that they, you kind of have like the firm. I mean, they have a person who's on site, but it's something that they essentially offer just a really high level of energy usage analysis. And also, I think the training part is really important.
Yeah.
Matt also, we just wanted to tie on there. It's data driven, a lot of it. So the data will tell you which your buildings might need, you know, you have losses out your roof, your windows. They can pinpoint that something that may not be so obvious as energy losses through the data. So that was a big help, especially when you're planning on where we're going to get the best bang for the buck for the improvements.
Yeah, that sounds great. Is that it's a one-time, is it going to say paid consultant, or is this a full-time ongoing position?
It would, if the NYSERDA program works for 1 year, it's like you get the person for a year. I think the goal of the program is they pay for the bulk of the cost of it, and then you know enough about how to do all these things that you're at a higher level at the end of the year, correct?
Well, and I think I heard the guy from Arlington talk about what their process had been, and they used an energy manager. And then at that same time, they found a teacher who was very interested and paid the teacher a stipend. And so that teacher sort of became the direct contact with the staff and teachers. So it actually wasn't the director of facilities who became the main director of that information, which they all felt very strongly was a good idea. So I wasn't sure, I mean, you interviewed people, but what is the timeline to choose an energy manager, or are you waiting? What's the status of those interviews?
It's been in a little bit of a holding pattern, but I'm assuming the timeline is this spring starting in the summer.
Also, BBS has some experience. Pasquale, the architect, has some experience with NYSERDA, so he was going to also help us with the final push.
So hopefully spring to summer, or like start.
And is the district thinking of trying to have a teacher on a stipend to be that liaison, or
I'd have to learn a little bit more about it. I don't think at the level the Arlington person is.
No, I mean that was a big, yeah.
But we're open to a lot of stuff.
If one of the teachers that are doing the environmental clubs was interested, it might be a great way to bring it into the clubs and into the curriculum.
Yeah.
All right, the fun part, the pictures. So here we have on the left-hand side, you have the new pavement over at South Avenue. There's a little white from some of the salt that we dropped, so that's what you're looking at there. Up on top, there's a 10-spin at Sargent. Down below is some new features at Forestville Elementary in the playground. And Anthony, on the right-hand side, that's a Gaga pit up top. It's a game apparently where they, and I don't know the specifics, but they bounce the ball around and they, almost
they
a dodgeball?
They play it at Sharp.
It's like dodgeball?
Yes. Yeah. Dodgeball means Thunderdome.
Okay. Yeah.
All right. No, it's bounce the ball it's actually, really high.
Yeah.
It's a really high bouncing ball, and then
I want to defend
try
it.
To catch it.
I love it.
Thunderbone. I don't think that's a compliment, so I just want to say that where I first heard about it was when my older son went to Sharp for the trip, and they had a Gaga pit there, and everyone came back just raving about the Gaga pit. And Sharp is all about team building. All of the work that they do focuses on that mission. So
I was a chaperone at Sharp. I saw it.
Yeah.
The Gaga pit there was packed the entire time.
Yeah, and it's relatively peaceful. I mean, kids are moving around a lot, so.
Contained.
It's contained.
This one here specifically is one that we had some teacher volunteers assist in as well.
How tall is it?
I would say 3-4 feet, something like that.
Okay.
Would you say at this point that the playgrounds at all four elementary schools are pretty much sort of equally well equipped? Do you think that there needs to be
I think some might be limited in the amount of area that there is to utilize. I think we're working towards that equity. I think we're close. But there might be some still that, you know, could use a little more, and we're working together with the PTOs and the school admin and trying to figure out how we can improve.
Do you think that would be in the plan for the school year?
Typically, there is plans to improve playgrounds every year.
Every year.
Yeah. Even if it's as little as replacing the mulch and keeping it fresh and that sort of thing.
A similar question along those lines, it seems the right time to ask. In terms of PTO fundraising, are they pretty equal across schools, or do some schools excel where others don't?
I don't know the answer to that.
Okay.
Yeah.
Is that anything we've ever looked at, you just met about finding some way to equalize that? I don't know what.
I mean, there's a collaborative of where all the PTOs work together and they communicate. And I don't know how often they meet. A lot of their communication is by social media. I mean, but it's something they can probably tell you. And some PTAs, I think South Avenue, I know South Avenue does, and probably all the other ones usually let everybody know how much they've raised in a year. So, I mean, you could compare.
Some more pictures. So on the left-hand side, we have some of the South Avenue, the new basketball assemblies, backboards, some of the new treads and risers that we put up as well. And on the right are what a typical new cubby looks like. This is the most recent one here at Glenwood Elementary. Also want to highlight some of the improvements that we made during the capital project over the summer. So on the left-hand side, we have two great twilight pictures of the new turf field. Top right-hand side is the field being utilized during PE class. New scoreboard at the field, and again, another shot of including some bleachers at the new turf field. Left-hand side, we have the new aquatic, quote-unquote, scoreboard, more like a jumbotron for video. So. That's at the pool on the left-hand side, and on the right-hand side is just a typical new unit ventilator. This one, I believe, is at Brownbout. These are a little jumbled. They're a little small, but we have on the upper left-hand, bottom left-hand side, you have the new science lab at the middle school. Top center is a new the ADL classroom, and towards the right-hand side is some shots of the new home and careers room at the middle school. They came up great. Okay, future consideration. So next year, we're really looking to purchase a new dump truck with a snow plow. So a skid steer, just a larger piece of heavy equipment. So we can do more in-house site work and snow removal. Typically now we're either renting or contracting out this work. So it'd be nice to be able to handle a lot of this larger work in-house. We need new floor machines in several schools. Floor machines that we have are rather antiquated and just not quite as good as they used to be, so we need some updating there. Our generator at Roundabout is currently down. When comparing prices, it's actually cost more to repair what's there rather than replace it, so we're looking to do a full replacement of the unit.
And the new dump truck, is that replacing an existing vehicle?
Yes, it would be replacing an existing vehicle. We have a pickup with Sander in it right now that's really in rough shape. We also have one of our dump trucks that during all winter long has a large Sander in it. So that limits us to one dump, and a lot of times one isn't enough. That would really to be replacing the one pickup.
And for the generator, where is the generator located in Roundabout?
That is in the area. Do you know where the dumpsters are? Faculty parking lot, gym would be on the right, cafeteria is on the left, and there's kind of an alleyway right down the middle, and it's just to the left there.
Do you know how what the size of that is, what capacity it is?
Nope.
No.
Not offhand.
And it's not working now?
It is not. It is an, I know that the motor size is 8.1 liter, I believe. that's all I have for you at the moment.
Okay.
All right. I can look into that, though, and let you know.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Some more considerations. So for security purposes, we're looking to rekey all of the district's doors. We've worked closely with Mark Thomas, member of the district safety committee. We're noticing some inconsistencies in some of the locking mechanisms, as well as some antiquated locks that are still involved. So what we're looking to do is update all the locks district wide in order to make it safer and make it more current. So that's a priority.
Is that mechanical keys?
Yeah.
Are we talking about electronic keys? And
this
is part of the smart bond.
Sorry.
Go ahead.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah. So this is not smart bond related. This is just actual mechanical core replacements. It wouldn't be the hardware or the complete lock sets, but they would be core rekeying. Mm-hmm. And we work together with Mark Thomas and any kind of consultants in order to make that more current.
But we have the electronic locks, like Mike's talking about. Those are part of the smart lock.
Those are part of the smart. Yes.
Would those be compatible, or if those came through, would it then be? Would we then be replacing them again with something else?
No. So the electronic badge swipes. Those are typically for the exterior doors in the building. There are some areas inside in the high school that they're utilized, but typically for exterior. This would be for all of, let's say, the LGI locking doors or classroom doors and nurses' offices and main offices and that type of thing that you would use an actual key for. So every couple of years, the pool needs to be drained, repairs need to be made, it needs to be resurfaced and then refilled, and that's something that we're looking to do over this next summer. It increases the longevity of the facility in general. And it needs some work, so we're looking to do that this summer. Okay, on to the numbers. So you'll see some increases here. Some of these salaries have increased, and that's just due to contractual increases. This particular equipment line here has been increased in order to be able to purchase the skid steer, some of the floor cleaning machines, and also for the generator. Utilities flat, the telephone here is increased, but I believe Mike Healy covered that in his presentation. We just housed the line. Water flat, supplies are flat. This contractual increase here, it would be for the rekeying of all of the district's locks.
So on the equipment line, so you listed a number of things under equipment for $90,000. What were they again?
It would be the skid steer. In this particular one, it would be the skid steer.
Okay.
The floor machines and the generator.
Okay. And so the total of those three is $90,000.
Where does the dump truck fit in?
That's the next slide.
Next slide.
Oh. Operations side.
Can you, I'm sorry, but can you just explain the difference between the two lines, the facilities budget and the operations budget, how that's broken up?
These are all SED codes, so facilities is mainly custodial and things that have to go on in the building. So the salaries that are in there are the custodial staff, whereas in operations, it's the maintenance and the grounds people, and then that's where the truck would be as well, and those some expenses related. It's just, set up a little bit differently.
And that's this slide here. This is the operations, so this would be the grounds. Again, a little increase, contractual increase. Equipment line here has been increased, and this is for the dump truck. Supplies are flat. Contractual here, this increases for the pool repairs, and the BOCES service is flat as well.
So the dump truck's here.
Yes.
In this, the operations budget, not in the...
yes, because it's more of a grounds maintenance type.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Down the road, so as always, we're always looking to identify immediate, non-immediate facility issues can be resolved through the general fund. It's kind of a revolving door. It's what we do on a daily basis. As part of the pre-referendum services for this capital project, BBS will conduct a building condition survey, and we'll use this info along with other collected data to develop a scope for a future capital project, as well as keeping the board goals and strategic plan in mind in doing so.
The building condition survey will also help us in future years in the facilities and operations budget. So when we did the project last time, there were smaller things that the general fund could pick up as far as operating budget and not have to go to capital. So we're hoping that that will also be apparent after they do the building condition survey.
Yes, actually, we'll say that Anthony, when he took the helm, did do a significant number of those items that we had in the building condition survey. Originally, we had them in the list of the capital project. He was able to, with his crew, really knock off quite a few, so that was really good.
And did you, through your work with Jeff and Anna, identify anything that might bring down, like, have you done anything from the information you guys have collected yet, or there have been really no changes made at this time?
Not really. We're still collecting data. Every month we do input on Portfolio Manager. I think we're looking to get kind of a full year's worth of data before we kind of figure out where it is that we want to go with it and where we can improve. Mm-hmm. But we do continue to input the data and see where we are.
We also have a contract, right, for the high school to help out now with tweaking or managing the HVAC in the high school.
Oh, right, yeah, with Train, yep. Being done here, yeah.
Yeah, so that's important. So you're hoping to see, that'll add to your data, right?
Absolutely. Yeah,
with the system operating properly, you'll give data to see, okay, what parts of the system or building do we need to modify in order to improve performance, because it was a lot of things out of service and not operating properly.
Thank you for the presentation. The sustainability efforts are not including greenhouse gas inventories?
I don't believe so.
Okay. And were you able to ever find the P2 report?
I do have the report. Yeah, I could send that along.
All right.
Yeah.
Thank you. Yeah, I mean, if the rest of the board members were interested.
That was that's the report that we did with the recycling audit.
Yeah.
That you'd like to see? Sure. I'm sure that I have it somewhere, and I'll send it along.
Okay.
And what is the P2 report?
Can you explain?
So it, New York State. Sorry. I don't know the.
It's like Pollution Prevention Institute.
Yep,
or something.
Right. Thank
yeah.
you. And it was an audit that really Karen Pagano really worked closely with the organization, and they came in and they at Sargent and they kind of ripped apart the garbage and took it out and separated it item by item, fruit cup by fruit cup, and saw what was trash and you know, where we can afford to kind of cut back, and it's there's a whole report with pictures and everything. It's quite interesting, and so from that we kind of started moving forward with Karen. Again, Karen did most of this with the PTO at Sargent, but where they could cut back, ordering different things or not ordering styrofoam, and really looking where they can cut back on those. On those waste products. Yeah, it's cool.
And are any of the, are all of the schools using reusable trays now, or some still using styrofoam?
Some are still, I don't believe they're using styrofoam
okay.
anymore.
No,
but not all of the schools have the dishwashing equipment, the tray washing equipment, in order to use the reusable trays. I believe we've moved to either a compostable tray or
yes, she's using compostable trays right now. She has the three, the high school and two of the elementary schools, Sargent and Forestal, are using the washable trays.
The washable trays.
And right.
Just as a statistic, that brought the bags of garbage down from 48 bags daily to 12, which is huge.
That's amazing.
Just from the trays.
That's
wow.
amazing.
Yeah.
And to follow up on that, what kind of modifications would be needed at the other schools to be able to convert?
Yeah, I mean, we'd have to do some redesigning and installation of dishwashing machines in those kitchens. So there would definitely need to be some architectural design in order to do that.
Is that within the scope of routine budget operations, or is that the capital program?
Yeah, that would be capital.
We're including Karen Pagano on the list for the architect to talk to.
Good.
do we have space on school grounds to do, I guess, composting ourselves, make it part of the curriculum?
It came up, composting came up at the Wellness Committee, and the representative from Hudson Valley Seed was taught, I'm looking at Flora, she's going to help me remember
the details. An industrial composter.
No, no critters around?
And to handle what we would need. And that it could possibly be something that we...
Yeah, at the Wellness Committee, I brought up, and I'm trying to bring it up everywhere I go now, that we will be having this new capital project, and we're open to all ideas. And so it was a very brief discussion, but that came up from both the Common Ground folks and Hudson Valley Seed. That's something we should think about. So
I think it's worth, just because I didn't know this, that compostable plastic cannot be composted in a normal home composting situation.
Yeah, there's a lot of stuff that can.
Right. But just because my understanding is that in order for the compostable plastic to actually be any better, it has to go to a special facilities.
I think an industrial composting system would be equipped to deal with that, which is why that's what we would want. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
What would it take to look at our buildings to see if we can harvest stormwater for water conservation to feed the gardens that we have?
Yeah, again, that would be up to something that I have to look into. I don't have the answer to that specific question. It's been tossed around as part of the overall sustainability efforts, but I don't really have an answer that I can look into.
We could probably get some help from our architect, because that is one of the things that they specialize in.
It's not a BOCES service, right?
No.
I think getting a skid steer is probably a good investment. That's a pretty handy piece of equipment with different attachments you can put on it. How would you see using that, for example?
Oh, endless, just like you said. From ball fields to snow removal to paving and site work that we could do in-house. there's attachments that can help cut limbs of trees and dig holes with augers, and it's really endless, and it's a really valuable and a piece of machinery that is fairly easy to operate, and it's really versatile.
Do you looking for a new one? I was just reading one of our new policies here. It says looking at used equipment too. So we're going to look at those avenues as well.
Yes.
Sure, there's probably some viable used equipment. So
yes.
Policy.
We were able to use the auction place to dispose of some of our older vehicles, but when Anthony was looking on the site, there's some very gently used equipment there, so we were able to do that, so
it
would be perfect.
All right. Good, thank you.
All right, thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you.
Ron?
Good evening. I'm Ron Ack, the Transportation Supervisor. I did include some of the names of my full-time key staff here who really keep things rolling over there with us. I just wanted to acknowledge them. They do a really good job each day. So I'm here to talk about the transportation budget this evening. And we're going to start right in with a quick summary of some of the things that we do. Most of you know we have six public schools here in Beacon. Students within the district, I have them going to 52 different school programs. So it's a pretty diverse operation. We currently transport to 16 private schools. We have students who are enrolled in three more schools that are outside our mileage limitation that we do not transport to. And in terms of the special education students, we have 20 sites that we are transporting to, another four sites that are contracted, and then we have, to my knowledge, three students that are in residential programs that have been transported throughout the year. So it's a pretty busy place, especially on mornings when there's 2-hour delays and things like this. Oh.
You mean a morning where everyone else was on a 2-hour delay
except
us?
For us.
Just to clarify.
A lot of our tiers are tiered with other schools, so it makes a lot of fun. So here's a shot. These are the buses that we got last year. We got two conventional 72-passenger buses, and then we had four vans. And I have to tell you, it's quite a challenge to get them all stopped and lined up at the same time because they're always rolling. So the quick summary of the fleet, we have 29 buses, two of which are equipped to transport students in wheelchairs. 28 vans, six of those have wheelchair equipment, and then there's 10 cars in the fleet. So we have a total of 67 vehicles right now in the district. Our human resources, this is actually a summary of our staff that we have. I have 48 drivers, and that number of two with WC for workers' comp just changed to three. I have three people out on comp right now and two people on medical. So we have those 48 minus two, about 44 drivers to get kids to those schools. Six substitute drivers, 27 bus monitors, three substitute bus monitors, two dispatchers, my morning and afternoon dispatchers, two head bus drivers, one head mechanic, and we have three mechanics now for, I think, the first time, one supervisor, and we have a part-time typist position, which is technically vacant, but we have a very able-bodied person assisting us at this time, so.
Question about something you mentioned earlier, your dispatchers, are they dispatchers slash bus drivers, or are they strictly dispatchers?
The 48 drivers listed are school bus drivers
only.
Just about everyone in the department, with the exception of the monitors, the typist, and one mechanic, can all drive
the bus.
We're all qualified to drive. You know, it's usually a bad day if you see me out driving, so.
But you will.
But I do drive, yes.
It's
actually one of the fun parts of the job. I enjoy getting out there and doing, just don't get to do it enough.
And how is we've talked for a number of years about driver shortages. How are we doing in that department?
Well, I mean, the important thing to remember is the buses don't drive themselves yet. Everybody's talking about autonomous vehicles. So recruitment and retention is really important, something we spend a lot of time on. You know, I talked last year about the Federal Motor Carrier Safety Administration enacting the entry-level driver training requirements. That was just officially postponed, I want to say 2 weeks ago. There was a lot of chatter about it in the industry where magazines and trade magazines were reporting that it was going to be delayed, but it wasn't official. Federal Motor Carrier hadn't issued an official statement. But now it's been officially delayed, so that won't be enacted until 2022. We do have, you can't go past the bus operation without seeing the sign drivers wanted. It's there everywhere. Matter of fact, I even got where I live, they're sending out flyers. Some of the local companies are sending them out. So it's an issue. We're constantly trying to recruit and train. The number of people that I've hired in the last 10 years between drivers, monitors, mechanics is about 180. So.
What's your ideal number of full-time drivers then?
That kind of depends on the enrollment that we have and the number of schools that we have to go to. So I talked a slide back about having 52 programs. So this past year, we had 9 schools that we were transporting to previously that we no longer needed to transport, but we got another 7. So it's just when you think you're gonna cut down on the number of drivers you need, you get more schools. We had a student added to another school, say a couple weeks ago, and these changes happen based on, you know, student needs and PPS placements throughout the year. We'll have students that change schools in May and June. So it's really, really hard to know. I would say right now I have about 4 positions I'd like to fill, and I anticipate 2 of my longtime drivers who are gonna be retiring at the end of this year. I did, This past year, we had a husband and wife team that just retired and another driver. So between those three people, that was about 60 years of driving experience that, you know, we lost within a month and a half.
Can you explain, I guess, the difference between which drivers are full-time, which ones are part-time?
The only full-time employees we have are the folks that I mentioned in the first slide. Myself, the two dispatchers, the two head bus drivers, and my mechanic staff.
Okay.
Everyone else is part-time, considered part-time.
Is that what's maybe perhaps impacting the being able to hire? Or?
There's probably a lot of factors that impact hiring. It's very competitive. We do a lot of our own training. So once you get someone trained, you're kind of giving them a skill that they can take somewhere. So there's nothing really to hold them once they get that license. So.
And they're part-time because we only need them a couple of hours every day, is that right?
Well, we only have part-time driver positions. I don't have full-time driver positions.
But are they defined as part-time because of the number of hours of work they do per day, right?
They're civil service titles, so they're part-time drivers.
So our bus drivers work in the morning and then have the midday off and then come in the afternoon. Some other districts have a different model, which would be cleaning, but we don't have that. So that's why they're only work, you know, five and a half, 6 hours a day.
Right.
So they'd be part-time.
Okay. And we do have midday things that we do with people, exclusionary of trips. We do have CTI runs that are done each day, midday. We do a work program at the high school that is done, I believe, 3 days a week. So those drivers are making, in addition to the morning and the afternoon, there's additional hours in between.
So Emery, you brought up that other model. Is that other model working better? Or I mean, not better, but like, is it?
Is retention better?
My understanding is we had that model here before and it wasn't successful, which is why they aren't continuing it. But those districts that have the full-time model are also looking for bus drivers. So it's not because they have full-time people. It's just a driver shortage all over.
Thank you.
Just moving on to the vehicle needs. Typically, I talk about the vehicles that we want to surplus first, but this year I want to talk about what we want to do to try and fill our needs. So rather than just replacing vehicles that we are surplusing because of age and condition, I want to try and talk about getting the fleet to where we need it to be and then surplusing after that. So this year we're looking to get two 72-passenger conventional style buses. They list for $115,376, and then three 20-passenger Chevy vans. They would list at $53,107 apiece. So for those five different vehicles, it would be a total of $390,075.21.
Can you review how the aid works and how we finance them, just so we get an idea of the impact?
So when you purchase a bus, you get transportation aid over 5 years. So we do a borrowing, what's called a bond anticipation note, and every year we add to it. So we just raise the levy by the amount of the payment for the first year. So we're basically matching the expenditures of the buses to the revenue that we'll get in transportation aid.
So basically, they basically offset each other?
There's a little bit of cost, but we have our transportation aid is in the high 60s, so 60% of it is paid for. So it's only a 30% increase.
So even though we're purchasing new buses, in this case it would be two full-size 72-passenger, three 20-passenger, and we have this large $400,000, in reality we kind of get all that given back to us in aid over
right.
the 5 years.
Right.
So it's actually, it is, you know, it's important to note that, you know, you have new buses, you have new equipment, we have less opportunity for breakdown, things like that. So even though we have these equipment, you know, these vehicles coming up every year, it's not, you know, we're not paying $400,000 right out of our pocket for it.
Correct.
And there's a lot of benefits for it.
Right. So some of our older buses will cost us more in repairs and parts than what it's worth to actually do it this way and spread the financing out over the 8.
And have we been ordering our new buses with cameras?
Yes, most of the buses, I would say all of the buses that we have purchased in the last 10 years all have a camera system on them. It's a hard drive camera system where we can pull the hard drive out. There are a few buses that are older than that that either don't have a system in it or have a system that's pretty much obsolete. So we are looking to, we do have systems in all of the buses we've had since 2010.
Mm-hmm. So are the buses that you'll get to the surplus, are those don't have cameras, or are they the obsolete cameras?
So we have pulled cameras out of some of the ones that we turned in. Mm-hmm. And so we can put those into older buses. It's just a labor expense to do that, having the contractor come in to do that installation.
But in general, we're improving our fleet, improving with the latest safety and other amenities. And not that the ones we have are not safe, but it's always the...
Yeah, well, like the new buses have some of the new technology in the cars. The front brake warning systems,
oh, really?
The departure systems, the new ICs that we're looking at have those systems in place. Mm-hmm. They do come with an expense added to it, so that's why you see some of the costs going up. And there's also an associated maintenance expense on those parts, because with DOT, if it's on the bus, it has to work. So if you have a system on there that, you know, not that any of our drivers would be following too closely to begin with, but you have these systems on them, they have to be functional.
Okay. Have you looked at propane buses?
I have looked at propane buses. I haven't seriously considered them, only because there's infrastructure changes that happen. And some of the, they work well for some districts. I don't know that they would work well for us here.
Why?
You have to do the infrastructure, the fueling, the amount of time it takes to refuel them is a long time. It doesn't fill up as quickly as a diesel or a gas engine. And then you have to do different maintenance stuff on them. They are very nice in that they're very, very quiet, which is really nice. If you've ever just stood next to a diesel bus running versus a propane bus.
And are they more energy efficient?
They are more expensive to purchase on the onset. So you may see larger districts going with some of the propanes because they can absorb the cost. Each year we're struggling for two buses here, two buses there. So in terms of the numbers, if we start looking at the expense of propane, it drives the initial purchase price up on the buses.
So is a part of that not aided if you're going with expensive like propane, or is it all?
It's all aided.
It's all aided, mm-hmm. So.
It's a percentage of whatever.
Yeah. I mean, we should maybe have a study or some kind of report by some time of the differences, maybe.
Yeah. So you'd have to do a phase in, phase out.
Well, sure, but at least have some kind of, instead of an I don't know, maybe a here's a study and we can set out a plan for that.
Yeah, no, thanks for bringing that up. I was going to ask about the alternative fuels, whether we were looking at that. I mean, propane's one of them.
So I don't know how we actually request that, but it sounds like we probably should.
So what we could do is, later on, we could get a consensus of the board to see if that's something that we want, and then we could charge.
I have a question about the price. How do you manage to know at this point down to the penny?
These vehicles are listed on what's called the OGS website, so they're a state contract. So the state, if you're familiar with OGS, they give us prices for everything from school buses to pencil sharpeners to, I'm sure Anthony buys a lot of equipment off OGS too. So that's a set price. That's the price that has been agreed upon between the vendor and the state contract. Right, and the state has gone out and gotten the best prices on that. So it saves us a lot of legwork from trying to go out and get competitive bids.
How many different competing manufacturers are there in a given category?
Typically, you have different vehicle vendors that are out there, International, Bluebird, Thomas. These are for internationals, which primarily most of our fleet is comprised of. It's good to have familiarity in your fleet, standardization, because it makes the repairs a lot easier, and we find them to be reliable products.
So how much difference in cost would it be for the different manufacturers?
It's really, yeah, it's pretty much the same.
The costs are relatively similar. It's just a matter of choice as to what manufacturer and what the mechanics feel more comfortable with working on.
And what your drivers are trained on. Because we have, if you have buses that are different in the fleet, when that driver gets in the bus to let that student out and goes to open the door, that door switch wants to be in the same place from bus to bus. You don't want a driver trying to figure out where the door switches are when you're loading and unloading students.
Could you, I don't mean this as a challenge at all, but if we have 48 drivers and a fleet of 67, why are we increasing the size of the fleet?
Because not every vehicle can be on the road at the same time. We have vehicles that are out for scheduled maintenance, scheduled DOT inspections. We have vehicles that are reserved for sports trips, things like that, field trips. So typically, you know, you need to have more vehicles than you actually, we can't run with the exact number that we need.
So do we have an ideal for increasing the size of the fleet this year by two? Do we have an ideal target number we hope to get to in the next 5 to 10 years? Or
so Ron, why don't you do the next slide first, so I think it'll be helpful, because you're not, it's not gonna be
I skipped ahead, I'm sorry.
No, that's okay.
That's okay. And just on state aid, it's important to keep aware of what the proposals are for state aid, because transportation is currently an expense-based aid, and there are some proposals to roll it into other things which would be enrollment-based.
Yeah, I was going to ask how the transportation and building aid are on the chopping block.
That's really important, because with enrollment, just because you lose 5 or 10 kids in the district, it doesn't mean that you're going to necessarily decrease the amount of vehicles and staff that you need in your fleet. Okay, so the surplus vehicles, right now what we're looking to do is to surplus 1 72-passenger bus and 2 school vans. I'm going to talk about the bus because that's a really classic example here. This particular bus, I'm not mentioning the number, but from July of 2018 till January of 2020, has incurred almost $20,000 worth of repairs for a total mileage of 9,956 miles. So it's becoming, it's almost like $2 a mile just to run this bus in repairs. So that's kind of why what replaces this bus.
What year is it and how many miles are on?
It is a, hold on. It's a 2009, and the mileage on it, this is as of January something when I sent the news reports. Approximately 116,000 miles on.
Thank you.
And some non-bus budget increases that we're looking at, some modest increases. We tend to run on a flat budget year to year, but this year we're looking at some moderate increases. On this slide here, we're looking for an increase in BOCES for $20,000. This actually seems like it's an increase, but taking that money is going to allow us, we've actually saved that money by using the Dutchess Wolsey's Cooperative Transportation Program. So this is one thing where we've saved almost $33,000 this year by using that program. So it's just a matter of putting those dollars into a different area. Some budget increases for transportation. Non-instructional salaries, equipment, insurance. So the non-instructional, the salary is a contractual expense and they make up most of the increases here. We're looking for an increase in $5,000 for supplies to cover the cost of uniforms and some other contractual equipment. Our maintenance software, because we do have software that keeps track of not only the vehicles, but the trips that we're doing and the driver requirements that we have to fulfill, which I talked a little bit about last year, all the different tests and things they need to do. That cost has gone up to a maintenance fee of $8,000 a year. And then some travel costs, an increase of $2,000 to allow some of my staff to partake in some professional development. Goals for the next 3 years. I put the facility stuff up first because we tend to focus on buses, but we do have some facility issues that we're concerned about. Our operational space that we have, it's getting very tight with us. We imagine all of these people on the first and second slides coming in and out of those rooms every day. Removing our underground storage tank. We have an underground diesel tank. We removed our underground gasoline tank back in 2011. And we installed an above ground gasoline tank. Now we're looking to remove the underground diesel tank, which was installed in 1997, and they have a lifespan of 30 years. So we're getting close to that lifespan. We want to make sure that we don't have issues with a leaky underground storage tank. We're looking at generator costs. Our doors are double wide, 12 feet high, and when the power goes out, there's really no way to open or close them. So we always look at that scenario of, you know, the buses are in for the morning, we get a storm, we lose power, we want to send the kids home, and we can't get the buses out of the garage. So that's something we want to be able to do. We want to be able to pump fuel. We want to be able to run our computers and our phones. So that's something that we're looking at for power.
What's your estimate for a generator?
I don't have any right now. I don't know if you have anything, Amber,
right here. Are you talking about size or money?
Money.
So as you remember, the generator was part of our capital project, which we thought we could wait a little bit longer. So we're going to try to introduce it again on this capital project. It is a significant expense, which would be difficult to fund through the general fund.
Yeah, no, I just, and then
it's a bigger size than what Rombouts is. That's why.
Think a lot.
Yeah.
Yeah, because Rombouts wasn't that expensive. Right. I think this one was on for a lot more than what Rombouts had in their budget.
That's why it would be difficult to raise the levy just for that one expense.
Okay.
And so we have a 3-year plan here. What I'd like to do is to look at replacing this coming year, 2 buses and 3 vans. We're talking about surplusing 1 bus and 2 vans next year. And again, a lot of this depends on district enrollment and what's going on with our special needs students. 3 vans, possibly a wheelchair, and 1 bus next year. And then the following year after that, we would look to get 3 buses because I think we'll be in really good shape in terms of the vans.
So I'm looking at that. We're talking about gaining 2 vehicles this year, 1 vehicle in 2021-22, and only no new vehicles in 2022. Is that correct?
Yeah. To run the numbers a little bit, when I started here, we had 33 full-size buses. Now we're down to 29.
Okay.
There were times where we want to have, we're always working with athletics. We can give you 3 buses. Can you give us 4? We can give you 3 buses. So we want to be able to provide those services. And again, this is what we're talking about to maintain the level of service that we're providing now. So if, you know, there's any consideration of expanding services, we need to revisit this.
Is this, and I'm sorry, I'm not trying to stick on this, I just want to understand it. So in 22-23, we estimate you're projecting needing 3 buses, but then surplusing 2 buses and 1 van. Do you imagine that in the future moving on, that it would kind of be more like that, just replacing what we have once we get up to 70?
I'm trying to get to where we were before, so that we, to give you an idea, in the beginning of this year, we had one of our buses was out of service since June. Was involved in an accident, and it was out of service for 4 months. Last week we had a bus that was involved in an accident. We don't know how long that's going to be out of service. The vehicle was rear-ended. There was significant damage to the bus, so thankfully there were no injuries. But the bus is out of service, so it's really hard for us to predict when that happens. So if we have buses that are out of service for warranty work or repair, You know, we were really, really tight with athletics in the beginning of the year. We were trying to get them where they needed to go, but yet at the same time, be able to get our students back and forth, home to school, school to home as well. So having that extra room in the fleet allows us to do that.
What's the difference between the athletic teams when they use the buses and then the field trips? Do they not use the school bus for field trips? Or?
The field trips, for the most part, we try to work with the schools to have them done midday so that they're not leaving before 9:15 and they're back in service by 1:30 so they can do 2 o'clock dismissals. The athletics, typically those buses are leaving at the same time that we're doing afternoon bus runs. So if I have 3 teams that are going away on away meets or matches, those buses are not available to do school to home trips. So for the most part, like field trips. Last week, I've heard some of the other presenters talk about, oh, we did these trips, we did these trips, we did these trips. Okay, last week, the day of the, was it Thursday, Matt, when we had the incident with the high school, and we had 5 buses that were leaving Rombaugh to go to West Point. So we took 5 bus loads of students from Rombaugh over to West Point to see a basketball game, and that left at 9:15. So those buses were doing morning runs, and then they were available. To pull 5 buses out of service after 2 o'clock in the afternoon is a stretch for us.
So if it doesn't fit within that window, then I guess then they have to procure other services, right?
In June, we did 68 field trips. So we have a certain amount that we can go, I'll call it like block out time. We have a certain amount of trips that we can release buses for morning and afternoon service during those block out times. But we have to really watch that. That's why we asked the schools to give us 2 weeks notice on the field trips so that we can plan for these types of things. We also want to plan, if we have a DOT inspector coming that wants to see 7 buses that day, the state inspector wants to see 7 buses, we have to be able to present those 7 buses, floor swept, seatbelts perfect, everything's got to be perfect on those buses. And we don't want to have 5 buses going out on a field trip on the same day we have 7 buses scheduled for DOT. So.
What happened? There was conversation I think we had last year on the stop arm cameras. Is that still a thing?
Legislation.
The county executive's office has taken that over. It's very complex for each individual jurisdiction to deal with it because you have all these different law enforcement agencies. Even in Beacon, we have 2, 3. And so the county is the happiness of all superintendents in Dutchess. The county's taking the lead with this. So they are working out the deal and the arrangement, and they're going to be coming back to us.
I'm the local NIAF chapter president for Dutchess and Ulster County. So we just did a survey of all of our Dutchess County members, along with Bill Johnson from the Dutchess County Traffic Safety Committee. He works with the county. And they were trying to get an idea of how many buses are running within Dutchess County. The way that the bill works is the municipality has to enter into contract with the district. So the stop arm cameras are we're authorized to use them, but we're not mandated to use them. And we can't just go and decide we're going to do it. We have to have an agreement with a law enforcement agency. I had emailed a lot of the details to Matt and Marie back in August. So it's a very complex law. If you have a chance to read it. I think it was 35 pages long.
Okay. But is that going to be an added cost to us, I guess?
No.
Okay.
The county will get some of the revenue that's generated from fines. So, in sort of with them coordinating this across the entire county, I'm not speaking, it may be the exact language that the law uses, but that's, yeah, that's what we're moving
reading
forward.
Reading the law, what I got out of it was when a county is a municipality that enters an agreement with the district, the county pays 100% of the fees collected to the state controller, which then pays the county 90% and the local municipality 10%. So I don't think it's something that is going to be a revenue generator for the district. It's weird.
But we're not paying for the equipment either.
Well, that's a question because the district would pay the cost up front, then submit the cost to the municipality by September 1st for each preceding year to the municipality. The municipality must pay the district back the cost for installation, maintenance, and use of the systems by December 1st. The district must report to the legislature any payments made or due from the municipality within 20 days of payment being submitted or due. If the municipality fails to pay, it's a very complex law.
We'll read it, Ron.
I don't want to spare you, but I knew you were going to have
thank you.
On.
We'll read it. Move on.
Very good. Oh, moving on.
Any other questions? Seeing none, make a motion to move the executive session.
So moved.
Second.
To review the employment history of particular individuals and to seek legal advice from school attorney, state law attorney, client privilege.
So moved.
Mike.
Second.
Comments or questions? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried 8-0.
Sandy, thank you to the gentlemen for their presentation.
Yes.
Yes, thank you, Ron and Anthony.
Yeah, thank you. Very good.
Seeing none, parent groups. Seeing none, superintendent's report.
All right. Just wanted to provide a very quick update just on some things we're working on for the next month of budget season. And so one of the things that we are doing is we are taking all that good board goals work and strategic plan work, and we're putting it into this software, and we are populating it very busily for the last couple of months. And so I'm just sort of previewing it very briefly tonight. Our goal is that early March the board is going to have like a board view of this. And so we've built our whole strategic plan around the board goals. We figured that is a great launching point for all of our what we're calling with this program major actions and actions. And so you see right here, this is kind of like the overview stage or the overview page where it has all the goals, or in this case we're calling more strategies, but those are board goals. If you clicked on that, you would see all six, just moving right along. If you clicked on strategy two, you get our major actions for that. I don't have all of them in the screenshot, but this is just the first few. This is our one where we're working for equity for all students. And so these major actions are things like implementation of the dignity framework, implementation of equity teams in each school, implementation of the equity report card. The next one is hiring a more diverse staff. So with all those major actions, we have just what we call actions. These are the ones for the hiring that Bill's responsible for. Each of us are responsible for different parts of this. I'm just quickly going through this because I'm just trying to get you a sense of something you're going to have access to in about a month's time, which we're excited about. And then if this is the kind of thing that excites you, some people, this is not the most exciting thing in the world, but I happen to be one of the people that does get excited by this. I've never actually had something, I think I mentioned to you all before, you go on a lot of district websites and their strategic plan is like a Word document that half the time hasn't been updated in like 2 years. And so this is a live document. We're going to be linking it to data over time, and there will be like a public dashboard as well that we also hope to unveil probably a little bit later in March, so the board part in a few weeks, and then the public dashboard we're hoping at the end of March. But it will really show all of the major steps we're taking and then some of the supporting actions to move the board goals and strategic plan further along. So. And it's also humbling for us because there's some that we've been focusing on more than others, and it causes some reflection on the team that we need to move, you know, some of these other actions forward more. But I just wanted to again preview something that we started this year. We've really been ramping it up the last few months, and we really hope that it plays a part in the first board meeting in March, where we go over the instructional and professional development part of the budget, which is really kind of the heart of everything. So just, these are our upcoming board meetings. The next two, the next one, Don will be discussing the PPS budget, and then March 9th, a team of us will be talking about the instructional and professional development. Sorry, I left that word out, update. And so some things going into that March 9th meeting. We want to continue to provide this sense of three-year planning, which we started last year. Three-year planning for implementation of new coursework, for professional development, et cetera. I also, you know, we had our initial meeting at the facilities committee the other night with our new architecture firm, and we just started talking about the capital project, the next capital project, and it really, this is, I say early, because this is very early in the process, but we want to try to merge some of our long-range, we aim to merge our long-range instructional goals with what we want to try to accomplish in the capital project. So I'm seeing a strand already of, you know, our technology coursework, probably expanding Project Lead the Way, looking at the spaces at elementary, middle, and high school that, you know, we have students either doing makerspace or more hands-on technology kind of coursework. And so we want to take what we at least are thinking of doing, or just a thought of what we could do in the capital project, and merge that with how do we line up the coursework to support that. And so on March 9th, we aim to take an initial stab at that, knowing that the capital project will probably shift and change a little bit over time, and knowing that, you know, with more input, we may, you know, make adjustments to the instructional planning. But we really want to merge those two. I think for, it's kind of for my brain to absorb all this, but I think it would help everybody see that these two things are in concert that we're doing. Another thing I'm really working on right now is incorporating feedback into that, into both our thinking about the capital project, but also this March 9th board meeting from stakeholders. So once again, that students, parents, especially at PTO meetings, teacher leaders, administrators, just briefly about that, students, I'm doing student focus groups at all schools. I do fifth grades at each elementary school, and then I do sixth, seventh, and eighth grade groups. It's usually about 12 students, and then I do the same at the high school. So I end up meeting with probably about between 100 and 150 students. I ask them two major questions that are kind of a launching point. One is, how do you best like to learn? And then this, the more fun question, well, actually, they do really well with that one. And then the more fun one is, well, how do you think we should spend money in the budget? And they really give me some great ideas. Parents, I can basically ask a version of those questions at the PTO meetings that I do. Teacher leaders, Eric and principals are meeting with our content coordinators just to talk about any kind of smaller budget needs in individual academic departments in the district. And administrators, obviously, we meet with all of our administrators to go over to go over kind of what they're thinking. One thought that we have that we'll talk more about in March is to increase by a little bit our building budget, so principals have a little bit more site-based control over some of the decision-making. That's the way I was a principal for many years, and actually Eric too, we talk about all the time, and we'd love our principals to be a little bit more empowered to make some more extensive budget decisions at their level. So, the last part of this is also just develop a budget that supports the implementation of the strategic plan. We see PD being a huge part of that. You know, plans for implementing new courses over the next few years, and that capital project too. Anthony?
The feedback you're getting from stakeholders, that's for the budget, not for the capital plan, right?
It's kind of both.
Both? Okay.
The capital part I'm doing very light, just kind of open-ended, you know, what's on your mind as we head into the next capital project, and getting a lot of thoughts that way. Obviously, the building condition survey plays a part, you know, what we want to do instructionally, but, you know, it really helps to listen to folks, too. And so, you know, the timeline, I'm not officially talking about it tonight, but the timeline, if we're shooting for a vote for December 2020, we've got to really start, you know, these next few months are really crucial. So it's a great question for really to ask all those groups, and that's what I'm trying to do. Craig?
Craig was at one of the PTO meetings last week and got to hear, you know, some of people's thoughts about both of those questions. And I have two more this week, another one next week, and then one in March with the PTOs. And student focus groups are happening all through February.
Will this be a topic for board discussion at some point
in
the near future?
It would be a topic. I was sort of seeing, we have March 9th as the date that we kind of put all this out there, and then the next board meeting is kind of open in a way. We don't have like a department presenting, and my thought was that we kind of roll up our sleeves and we get more into it then as well.
Our next board meeting or the board meeting after?
In March. That's what I was thinking, but that would be up to you all if you want to restructure it at the next board meeting, because we
do
have
board
just one department sharing.
So it would be like March, the second meeting in March.
By that point, will you be very far along in the development of that, or by that point you would have already spoken to most of the people in the community and come to us?
By that point, I would have spoken to almost everybody, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Student survey, I believe that was an idea mentioned before.
Yeah, we it's called a student connectedness survey. It's kind of about their social emotional connection to both peers and adults in the building. And Eric is heading that up, and it's just about ready to go out. And we're gonna do that kind of upper elementary through 12th grade. It's just like a simple 7 or 8 question thing. That's come out of our dignity framework work.
And that feeds the capital project as well as the budget, or no, that's something to
the survey?
Yeah.
No, the survey is what we're looking at. The surveys to kind of establish a baseline of how well students feel connected to their peers and connected to adults in the building. That's sort of a different thing.
Okay.
We don't have a survey per se, although I ask all the student focus groups kind of what they think about the building and how we would improve.
And we have the architecture class going on now, right?
Yeah.
So, I mean, maybe the students there?
For sure.
Want to take a shot at?
Our architects have expressed a willingness to jump into that class when they're around too.
Cool.
That would be great.
Yeah. Real life examples.
Do we do any sort of, for the new classes that we've had at the high school, are we getting any feedback on those specifically from students, or more?
I know they're well subscribed. I think, you know, we were planning on having Elisa be a part along with some other building administrators, the March 9th thing, and so that could be something that we share more in depth that night. I think that lends itself to a bigger question of making sure that we also provide an overview of things we've already accomplished in previous budgets. And so when I do these meetings with any stakeholders, it's pretty informal, but I do kind of breeze through, here's what we've accomplished the last few years with the budget. I mean, when you look back and see what we've done with like class size at the elementary level, it's really strong. When you look at, you know, adding like the social worker at the high school, adding the art class work at the high school, you know, we have more things we're thinking about for next year,
we've added like a dozen new classes at the high school over the past couple of years, right, Eric?
I think it's really important for us to be doing more of this longer-term planning, especially if we're trying to make a difference where we create new paths in our overall curriculum. We've talked about hands-on things. It's not that we don't have anything. For example, everything in phys ed, sports, arts, music is all hands-on kind of learning. But that only covers small slices of the potential. And most of the rest we outsource to BOCES, which is good, but it limits who can participate in any of these kind of activities and doesn't, in my opinion, connect us to career possibilities as well as it could. We do a few things like have a career fair and so on, and have colleges come in, talk to students in an open house at night. But trying to redesign our curriculum by making any kind of large inroads at the same time we consider a capital program that could create the facilities that would make it feasible or better, at the same time we look at long-range planning and what the budget implications and staffing considerations would be. That's a very complicated task. I'm not telling you anything you don't know. But what is our plan for looking at that, and what can we do as a board to facilitate that kind of overall district consideration?
Well, you know, the plan is essentially some of the things that I've been talking about just the last few minutes. Like we're I think going above and beyond what a lot of districts do, and we're putting the strategic plan in our actions. You know, I know it's not out there yet, but we're charting them, we're, you know, monitoring how well we're doing, and we're gonna create a thing that's both sort of live with the board, and we'll have a public dashboard for the entire community. My goal with the capital project is, you know, you think about that, it's the vote would be December 2020. We learned at the facilities meeting it would probably be over two summers, so there would be improvements made or renovations made summer of 2022, and then another summer of renovations and improvements in 2023. So whatever we want to accomplish instructionally in this capital project, we need a backwards map from one of those summers to how are we ready to, you know, if it's a newly renovated space, how are we ready to program and staff this space? Mm-hmm. Whether with existing people we have, that they need to be trained, do we hire a new person? Like, what my goal, you know, in the next month is to sketch some of this out for you. I think from the board's perspective, and I think it's always worked for me, and I think we've had strong budgets the last few years, is you provide a lot of input and, you know, let's rethink this or try to do this one faster or maybe also try to think about this direction. That's what I would ask from the board. Craig, I love you being at, you know, that PTO meeting the other night, because like you got to hear straight from the constituents too. So I think all of those things, but we're trying. I use the word merge because I sometimes feel just other places I've been that some of the capital work is just sort of in this lane and the instructional work is in this lane.
Yeah.
And so I think it's sometimes as simple as just charting it out on a piece of paper. I mean, we're gonna have this really nice, you know, part of our website that has all of this, but the last facilities meeting, I started just sort of jotting down on a piece of paper, if we go in these certain directions, what all we need to do. I need to work on that with my team and principals and teacher leaders, you know, before I want to kind of put it in front of you in a more public way, but it's we've got to get those two lanes together, and we
can
do that.
That's a good way to put it. I think that's a very good analogy. They are silos. These things have to merge, so you got to pull it together. So
yeah.
So I have a question, kind of similar to that. We have cooperative agreements for sports, for the other schools outside the county. Has anybody looked at whether we can look into a cooperative agreement with the Newburgh CTE program? They're a lot closer than Soul Point Turnpike.
My understanding of this is you know you have the BOCES that you're assigned to, and so if we were to try to get that same or similar BOCES service at a different place, we'd be paying full cost, and we would not be getting any aid back at all in sending the students there. It's something I looked into in my previous district, found a couple issues with BOCES, and it's very clear, like you can't, like the only way we're sort of allowed to go outside of our BOCES is the BOCES of them specifically offer some service. And also, what I know of the programs, and I don't know this at an in-depth level, but the BOCES teachers in the CTE are qualified sort of at a higher certification level than the ones in Newburgh, from what I understand. So, you know, I always try to remind the board of this, that, you know, Beacon, I don't know the right phrase, per capita or per pupil, we send the most students to BOCES CTE program than any district in BOCES, you know, by proportion. And we have a good track record. Like, our students are really motivated to do it. We've kind of, thing in the past used to be like a cap on it, and we've just basically eliminated that. Like, any student who wants to be a part of that program, we really work hard to make them, to help them be a part of it. And so I see some really nice things starting to gel at Duchess Boces with their capital project. Just to, I'm seeing, like, you know, this is not exactly what you're saying, but like the responsive classroom PD, that's done through Boces. Essentially, we're partnering with Arlington to do it. And so all that PD that we're doing is we're getting aid back, you know, at a very high rate on that PD. The sustainability PD that's being approved tonight, or it's on the consent agenda, my goal for that is to get that through Boces so it becomes a countywide effort. But I hear what you're saying, but I really don't have a choice but to use Duchess unless it's something that we, Duchess absolutely does not offer. That's what I understand.
No,
I gave you a long-winded
answer. I appreciate that. But just hypothetically, if there was a class the Newburgh Free Academy offers that Boces does not offer,
was it more
complicated than that?
Well, it is more complicated than that. I mean, what I was speaking probably more to, like, services that Boces offers. Like, we, you know, utilize PNW Boces for a couple of things that is not offered through Duchess. So I'm not really certain it's just like a class that we'd be able to do and we'd get aid.
I wonder if this would be a good time, because we're talking about, thinking about the strategic plan, capital projects, and how that fits with curriculum. Something we touched on in policy committee, because we were looking at some of our policies for review of curriculum and textbooks. I wonder if this would make sense. I thought before when we talked about it, it'd be great to have a snapshot of the courses that are available. We mentioned maybe being able to review syllabi, not for any kind of comment, but just to have an idea of what's going on, and a list of textbooks. Is that something?
Isn't there a catalog of the courses?
Yeah.
For the high school?
Yeah, high school.
It's online, isn't it? It's on the high school website.
Syllabi or not, the list of textbooks we have are not. This was, we kind of discussed this, and I don't know, Anthony, when you want to go into this, but because you kind of referred to it earlier in the meeting, you know, like a board, a request from a board member or two board members, how do we process that? The board kind of achieves some sort of consensus saying, please look into that.
So what I was going to do is, prior to we get to our committee reports, I was going to say to the board members, if you have an individual request, right, it really, Matt shouldn't be looking into individual requests. He should be looking into board requests. So if you have a request, you need to bring it up, and you could, I think the appropriate time would be during your committee reports. Everybody has an opportunity to have a board comment. If you're making a request, then we could get a consensus of the board at that time, whether the whole board wants to make that request or not. Be mindful, it is budget season and stuff when you're making individual requests and so forth. But if there's something that you're intrigued and want Matt to look into, or to charge someone in the district to look into, I think that if you bring it up during board comments, then we can have, I'll keep a list, and then I could, when it's my turn to go as the president, I will go through and say, okay, we had an individual request for this, you know, how does the board feel on that?
Yeah, and I would just want the opportunity on a few of those to just weigh in from, like, the district's perspective about
absolutely
what, you know.
Just because I'm hearing more and more individual requests and stuff at the board meetings, and it becomes not a request of an individual, and it becomes misperceptions about personal agendas and stuff, where it's a board agenda, and it needs to be by the majority of the board. So
just to be clear, we talked about this specifically during policy committee meeting, and I thought we agreed that we would bring it up during Matt's comment. So I'm sorry if
I knew it was during one of the two, I think it would be easier just because when you're commenting, mm-hmm. instead of someone just racing to get something out, like, if you're giving a policy update, you could say, hey, and I have a request for a textbook list.
Right.
And then I could say, okay, textbook list. And then at the end, when I go last, I would say, okay, I heard individual requests for A, B, C, D. You know, how does the board feel? And then we could go.
Well, so to be clear, it felt germane because we're talking about curriculum. That's not a request for me. It's actually a request I'd like to propose to the board to see if that's something we would all like to see. but we're not talking about that now. We'll talk about it during
We're having a good conversation, and maybe this goes into a workshop at one of our meetings where it becomes a topic of basically what we have on the board there, and more in detail and specific ideas, some blue sky, some practical reactions, bring in some of the subject area experts if we can identify who they might be.
Okay, thank you, Matt.
Thank you, Matt.
Thank you. Grace, 4-0 on Mondays.
Hi, everyone. So the first thing I'll hit on are the new school entries that are just being rolled out. We kind of walked into school one day, and magically there was a new washing machine. It's like a runway with garbage cans. And it's running pretty smoothly, I think. I mean, I like the school lunches. So eating them on a cool lunch tray, I like that. And you just put it on the tray and it washes itself, so it's cool. And secondly, last Thursday night, the boys and girls had their senior nights. We played Poughkeepsie, no, Peekskill, and it was a great win. And before all the teams, we have six seniors on our team, so all the underclassmen picked one of us and made a poster and wrote a speech, and it was just a great feeling because I've been on the team for 6 years, so like, entire high school, middle school, and it was great to be recognized for everything. And then the boys had a great win against Lords. They previously lost. And tonight we had a big win against NIAC, so now we're going to sectionals.
Good.
So, great.
Yeah. I just gotta tell you, so I went to the end of the girls' game, and they were up 41-39, and it was a minute left, and the ball's in Grace's hands, and she able to seal the deal, and we got the 43-39 win. But just another side note, Grace had another commitment tonight, right? And so her mom said, what are you going to do? Are you going to go to the board meeting, or are you going to go to, what was it, lacrosse?
Lacrosse, yeah.
Lacrosse. And she goes, oh, no, I got to go to the board meeting. I said, so me trying to not to put pressure on Grace, I was like, well, Grace, you can go to lacrosse. If you have an update that you want me to say, you know, that you pre-wrote down, I will definitely read it for her. She was like, looked at me like, no, it's okay, I'll go to the board meeting.
Yeah.
But she is showing great commitment to the board, and she does. Your feedback is valuable. So we do appreciate it. And,
thank you.
You know, I know that you had a lot of conflicts and stuff, but you choose us over it, which is great.
Yeah.
So thank you.
Maybe we should schedule the board meeting around her sports.
I would love to. I think it would be impossible because she's in many sports and activities. All right, so thank you very much. Any questions for Grace?
Well, thank you very much.
I'm glad to hear the cafeteria report. It sounded a little like a really big change about the way things are done.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, it's easy, though. I think it's, and like how we reduced the waste from like 48 to 12, that's incredible. I didn't realize it made that much of an impact.
Yeah,
that's great.
Yeah.
Are the winter blues setting in at the high school yet? You guys ready for a snow day or anything?
Yeah, every school had delay except us. That was kind of disheartening.
Who makes that decision?
I can barely walk in the high school right now without like a lot of people making comments.
Yeah, thank you so much, Grace.
My son is working me now. It's getting rough.
All right, James, you want to go over policy?
Sure. We had a very productive policy committee meeting last week. I think we're really getting our stride in terms of getting a process of how to get through these policies efficiently. I just wanted to make a note. I know Matt mentioned it, but we have three policies that are on the agenda today where we skipped first reading and are going for final approval. Two of those, the policy committee did review, and we did not recommend any changes. So we, unless anyone on the board feels strongly otherwise, we will not be reviewing those again until we are required to. The third policy, 8410, student transportation. We did have some things we wanted to talk about, but since we need to get these in for our Title I audit, we didn't review that policy. We just know that we're going to review it next policy meeting next month, and those will be coming back for a normal process of first and second reads. As part of the discussion, we are looking at policies today for, we looked at the 4200 curriculum management and 4511 textbook selection, and that brought up a great conversation thinking about As a board, what are we doing to kind of keep an eye on just a general awareness of the curriculum? What are the classes that are being taught? How are they being taught? What are some areas that we want to think about ways to, when we think about building curriculum, what are holes in that? It's also part of our responsibility to think about that. So we, Anthony Singh was not there, but Alyssa, Anthony, and myself, we talked about how it would be great to have access to syllabi. Matt was saying that every class has a syllabi that's submitted. This would be just a week for our information, just kind of have a snapshot of what's going on. And then also we should get a list of textbooks that are being looked at. And we're actually responsible. We're supposed to give a review every 5 years. Obviously, it's not a total turnover of all the textbooks at once, but we'd love to have wanted to bring to the board at large to make a request to Matt for us to be able to have a list of textbooks that are in our schools.
Okay, any questions for James?
Yeah, what happens when there really isn't a physical textbook, but it's all kind of an online curriculum?
So we incorporated language into the policy for that.
Yeah.
Okay. It's digital textbooks as well.
One thought I have about the request is, we in the curriculum committee we are talking about curriculum mapping, which I sort of have had the same thing where we talk about these things and I feel like I don't have a complete enough picture to weigh in on some of the decisions that we're asked to weigh in on. So I was going to speak to Eric about creating a timeline for that curriculum mapping and kind of figuring out what the final product would look like that we would share with the board, but also the community, actually, so that
that's great.
People would.
Well,
just
my impression, Matt, correct me if I'm wrong, was that you already have the syllabi. I mean, I guess every semester teachers give you all their syllabi, so it's more of like a data dump rather than very much work to put that together. Is that right?
Yeah, the high school principal, Mrs. Soto, has them. I think the only thing I would, I think the textbook list is simply done. I think it would probably be good to provide maybe some sort of thinking behind the syllabi collection or what the board will be doing with them. Like, one of the things that always comes up is trust in Beacon, and I'm not at all, your intent is not a bad one, but like it's always something that kind of comes up because of the history in Beacon, and I'm not saying I haven't spoken to anyone about this, but with other issues it does come up, like, well, why, and is a board member then going to critique my syllabus or say why, like those are the kind of things that there's a potential. So I'm not saying like you're not allowed to have it. I think it's something just worth considering from the board angle of like why and who's looking at them and and is it just something. I'm also most certain a high school teacher would say, I don't care who sees it, like that, I send it out to everybody, and like I'm not saying they're trying to hide something. I just think it's something to contemplate,
right?
As trust, I've been here 2.5 years. And I'm reminded even 2.5 years in that the trust part takes a while to build. And so sometimes I think I've done all this stuff to build it and I still have a ways to go. And it's just something to think about with that specific one, just.
I am very sensitive to that. And I thought about even how to make this request, how to like word it. It's just honest curiosity. I teach on the college level. In the policy committee meeting, I am required to submit my syllabus every semester to my chair, and they don't make any comments. And if they did, I would be 100% entitled to be very upset. It's this like educate, like you should have, teachers should have total autonomy to teach their classes if they want to teach it. So I understand feeling how one could feel nervous, the idea that some authority is going to be reviewing it for what purpose. And I don't have any interest in scrutinizing the agenda. It's really just honest, like the bigger picture snapshot and curiosity more than anything else.
I think that's why I brought up the curriculum mapping, because I do think that it is I certainly share the desire to understand at a deeper level, and we were approaching it from looking for some continuity in our curriculum, looking for how we're aligned with our strategic plan through our curriculum. I do wonder if that steps on the toes of, you know, I mean, the syllabus is being submitted to the principal. I do not want teachers to think that, you know, that I'm looking over their shoulder in that way. I'm not sure, maybe, you know, maybe there is a way to do it that doesn't feel quite so intrusive.
Might there be an opportunity for the department heads and the, we're talking about the high school primarily, right? When we're
yeah.
talking about the syllabus.
Yeah.
Might there be an opportunity for our department heads to give a short presentation or a summary of what the lessons look
so
like?
So this is why,
topics look like.
Let's take the list down so everybody could get through and then we could have this conversation germane
okay.
to it at the end of all the comments so
okay.
people could get their comments out in the committees and then we could have that at the end of it. I don't want to stifle the conversation about this one, but I just want to be cognizant of making sure that the committee reports are done and then we could go into the conversations about the individual requests.
Fair enough.
Right. Oh, okay. I have no further comments for mine.
Okay. Craig?
Okay, let me start. I guess it'll be up to Michael and myself to talk about facilities and operations since Chris is not with us tonight. We did have a very good meeting with our team from our new architects, BBS. So this is our first meeting with them post-hiring. And it was very productive, I think. I think they've really got a good handle on how to do these kind of capital programs. And not just the nuts and bolts of architecture and engineering, but how you structure it in terms of what you can do for state aid and how you plan the schedule and so on. So I was pleased to see that kind of thinking and approach. We threw out a lot of ideas to kick around a bit. I'm looking forward to working with them in the future. We did also work a bit on trying to clean up the tail end of the existing capital program. We may be able to have some funds available within it after we settle everything and make sure that we have dotted our I's and crossed our T's, because there's a certain amount of soft costs and contingencies that are sort of built into it, and you hope you stay within budget, and we are. Actually, we may have some extra funds that we might be able to deploy in the direction of bleachers. We're investigating this now. That was the part where we went with temporary facilities, and I hope people understand those are temporary facilities. There's a saying among architects, there's nothing so permanent as the temporary, so be careful when you do it. So we're being careful to look at it and see if we can do it, and that's about as far as we can say right now, but so far, so good. For the public relations, advocacy, and legislative, Meredith probably should talk mostly on this because she just attended a session in Albany. Last week, I attended the County School Boards Association. They are were planning to contact a lot of the legislators and presumably did so. The presentation also talked a lot about green programs in the schools. Not specifically ours, because we're basically working with a different outfit besides the Poughkeepsie Farm Project, but it was interesting to hear that. So what we need to do is to schedule a meeting of our committee sometime within this month, and I'm wondering, can we do that right now?
Just give us a date, Craig.
Yeah, how about the 18th? Is that feasible? I have a couple of other dates, February 18th, maybe the 25th.
18th works for me.
Does it?
Doesn't work for me, but it's okay.
Are there other committee meetings? I don't know if we have a schedule that lists every committee now.
We have nothing on Tuesdays, I could tell you that much.
Okay.
Policy's always on Monday.
Is there any way we could do it before the 24th board meeting? Just start early?
Yeah, well, it could also be Wednesday of this week, but that's a little short notice.
I can't do this week.
No.
No.
Before.
Would that,
it works
would that
for
work
me.
For you, Alyssa? Could you do a 6:15?
What day?
And before the next board meeting on the 24th?
You mean that night?
Mm-hmm. Like, yeah, just before the board meeting begins.
Could do that.
I know that's hard for you sometimes to get here.
Supposed to be a modified girls' basketball dinner that night, but I could send my husband to that, and I could come to the...
Well, I don't want to keep you from it. If...
We
I'd
have
like
a
to go to the basketball
child on
dinner.
That team?
Yeah, that's fine.
I'm sorry?
You have a child on that team?
Yes.
I would choose that over...
Yeah, I was looking forward to seeing the inside of St. Rocco's or whatever that place is.
Well, the committee can go to the modified dinner...
That sounds good.
What was that?
I said the committee can go to your dinner.
I don't think we're, I mean, if we're going to be talking about budget developments, I think later is a little bit better, like maybe the week of the 24th.
Yeah, that's good. The 25th, 6th, or 7th. Wow, look at those. That's true.
I could do, so far, any of those are so good for me.
25th or 26th would be okay for me. But...
How about you?
Did you want to do it before
Tuesdays
the meeting,
are no good.
Right?
Wednesdays are better?
Mondays or Wednesdays?
Why don't we do the 26th and 7 o'clock?
February 26th, 7th. Okay.
I have a question.
What was the policy? Hi, Grace. What was the next policy meeting? I'm sorry, I forgot to ask.
Oh, okay. Sorry, it's 3 Mondays from now.
You don't have to tell me right now.
Oh, okay.
Just if you could shoot it and then.
I have a question for Craig or the FNO committee in general.
Hold on 1 second. Let's make sure he was done with his comments first.
Craig, what time that night? The 26th?
At 7 p.m.
Got it.
Okay, the 26th. Okay, great. I did attend that meeting with the Glenham PTO. Matt gave a good presentation. I think it was very good at eliciting comments from the members. Some people tend to be a little shy. But I think we got a lot of good feedback, and these sessions are quite valuable. Teachers are also present, and they know how the school runs. It's good to get their input as well. So we're in the early stages of collecting feedback and letting people know that we have ears open. I might be able to attend a couple more of those at some point, and I think it's worthwhile if I can manage the time. So, and the that's it, basically. So thank you very much. Question.
Bleachers.
Yep.
I feel like we should have a discussion on the board level about bleachers. I feel like some of us are speaking very matter-of-factly as if those are a done deal. And I feel like we haven't had any kind of board level discussion to, no one's asked me what I think about
it. It happened back where the planning of the capital project was, that's why.
It didn't though, because we amended the capital project to change the bleachers to pay for lights. As part of that, I voted on it. We changed from permanent bleachers to temporary bleachers in order to afford lights.
Right, so that was a discussion because we said, well, we don't know if we're going to have enough money. Hopefully we're going to underrun, and it's easier to put up the temporary bleachers first and then come back with permanents if we have the money, because we could use the temporary bleachers elsewhere, rather than trying to put the permanent bleachers in and hold off on the lights, because
right.
it was like, okay, we're going to do the bleachers and the lights if we have money.
Right.
And at the end, we said, okay, listen, we're going to do the lights. So they're both in the scope. One was if we have the money left over. So it was part of the original conversation.
Right. And then when we made the decision to go with the temporary bleachers, that was, we had a discussion about that. And I remember I pulled it, and I specifically was asking these questions about when we say we're going to get temporary bleachers that are will replace someday in the future, are we putting ourselves on the hook for the very next capital project? And I think, well, I know the response was no, of course not. These are going to be fine. These could work if, because I said at that time and I said again, I would hate to put us in a position to where we buy something that doesn't work. You know, we pay $4 million for a project that's inadequate still, and we need to keep throwing more money into it. So I just wanted to know if we were going to have that discussion.
I'm not sure those facts are correct.
Maybe we're having discussion.
I'm not sure those facts are correct. You know, we said that, when you talked about, are we on the hook for buying something in the next capital project, it was, are we going to have money in this capital project in order to, you know, remaining after everything's said and done, in order to pay for these bleachers, and that's where we're at. That's where we're verifying that we're at.
Okay. we're verifying that.
So this isn't going into the next capital project. It is because there is money left over in the current capital project to pay for.
Yeah, so they're making sure that the work is getting completed and that the bills are paid and all the the paperwork and documents are going to be completed and submitted like they're supposed to, and then we're going to know what's left over.
Can you explain? Because there's a certain amount of money that was moved from the general funds to pay for the bleachers. Is that right? It was like $250,000 to $750,000, depending on.
Yeah, I don't know if that wasn't for the bleachers. No.
I don't remember.
The discussion was when they were purchasing, and I don't think they might have purchased some temporary bleachers, mm-hmm. but they knew that there was a need at other fields for those
right.
bleachers.
Right.
So that it wouldn't be like, oh, you're buying temporary bleachers and then they're not going to be utilized.
That, my understanding of that as well, that the temporary bleachers would be usable and, all over our school campuses.
And so those were paid for out of the general fund?
The SMRI, I believe. Yeah. I have to ask Mr. Emery.
Sure.
Exactly what I can.
Well, so to be clear though, so we're talking about remaining funds from the previous capital project, not talking about adding bleachers to the future capital project.
Correct.
Or adding bleachers to any.
We're still in the
general.
Old capital project.
Right.
We haven't went through a referendum vote. We haven't even started the planning as to what this next capital project will look like.
Okay.
So this is, we're still in that old capital project.
Okay. Well, that I don't have an issue with that. I would.
Yeah. No. It will only happen. That's why it's not a definite. It's they're doing all the accounting now of incidentals,
right.
et cetera, and if when all of that beam counting is done. The money is there, then that, which was part of the original plan, would happen.
Right.
And I hope that it is, because I watched the kids on the temporary bleachers at the football games. I don't think they're adequate for the football crowd.
One other point we should make is that the concrete pad where the bleachers go is already there, as well as the deep footings where the support columns for the bleachers are going to be mounted. So that was the kind of planning that you do to not box yourself out of options in the future, because if you don't do that, you may have to go back and rip something up or incur additional expense and maybe damage to the facility. The same thing with lights is that it was determined by our experts and architects that if we didn't do the lights now, it would be worse and harder and maybe impractical to do them later, because there's infrastructure that's needed for those. So
I'm gonna be clear, I'm totally I love the turf field is great. I'm glad that it's able to be celebrated the way it is, but I also want to make sure that it's not an open blank check, that we're, because I know we have a new flagpole, we're going to want upgrades to the press box, you could always make it better indefinitely. So
mm-hmm.
I just want to kind of have that part of our conversation, and I'd heard bleachers come up, as a matter of fact. So
yeah.
If they're part of the previous capital project, that makes a lot of sense.
Any other questions for Craig? Flora, wellness, are we well?
We're very well. So well. So we had our February meeting, and there are a lot of good things coming up. In March 21st, Hudson Valley Seed is hosting a family cooking event, and I don't have a lot of information on that now, but I will next month. So mark your calendars, there will be breakfast burritos. April 2nd is the College and Health and Wellness Fair at the high school, and the high school is getting ready for that. And also, we have the 5th grade field day happening on June 9th. And students are going to be transported to the field for that. So I think that'll be an exciting time. The Common Ground Farm folks are working on an international cooking session that coincides with the Calico Ball, so teaching the 3rd graders about some international foods, which is pretty cool. They're also working with Cornell Cooperative Extension to expand the Bee Project to 4th graders at all of the elementary schools. And that's programming where they learn about bees and pollination. They get to talk to beekeepers. They also have expanded the backpack program, which they recently took over. I think they took it over this year. And it's grown, and it now includes J.D. Forrestal, and it may be going to Sargent as well. So that's a great service that they're helping provide in the district. And just for anybody who doesn't know, those are meals that get, they work with the school counselors, and meals get packed and sent home to students in need, food insecure students in backpacks. And it's all donation and all volunteer work, and it's a really worthy cause. For food services, you already heard about the washable trays and the 75% reduction in garbage, which is amazing. And another initiative that's coming around for the government is that they're going to be banning the use of styrofoam, but as a district, we are already ahead of the curve on that, and we're no longer using it, so that's great. We're also looking at another professional development workshop, either in March or at the beginning of next school year, and they're getting pretty creative with their professional development, and they're looking at having a shop contest, perhaps running against other districts, so that would be pretty cool. I think that's great. It's great for education, and it's great for morale, so it's pretty cool. And then we also talked about the industrial composter, which I, for one, am very much in favor of. Our next meeting is Wednesday, March 4th at 4 p.m. at High School.
Wait, is an industrial composter a machine that we have?
No.
Or would get?
You're going to have to Google it.
Or is it like a place? But I'm just curious, doing it, is industrial composter a piece of equipment, or is it like a place?
It's a equipment that we would have on site.
Cool.
Yeah, I think it's equipment that can run at a higher temperature, so it can break down a much wider range of stuff.
Like compostable plastic.
Exactly.
Yeah, I mean, there's some industrial ones that can decompose meat.
Yes.
So,
the temperature inside some of those big stacks, it gets to be enormous. I mean, it burns up a lot of stuff.
Any questions?
I have a question for Flora.
Ready.
The backpack program. Can you tell me what some of the items are that go in those backpacks?
There's a lot of produce because it goes through, I think, you know what, don't quote me on that. I'll have to get back to you. I think some produce does go in there through
like
Common Ground
fresh
Farm.
Food.
It is, but it's also shelf-stable food.
Okay.
I think that the contents have changed a little bit since Common Ground
Farm
took
over. That's why I'm
asking.
When we first moved here almost 7 years ago, our first year here, I was recovering from a bad car accident.
Right.
And it wasn't working. So we partook in the backpack program.
Yeah.
And it was like Pop-Tarts and like canned fruit and the... I don't give my kids that stuff, so I'm glad to hear that.
I'm pretty sure
it sounds better
because of Common Ground's overall mission. Do you know that?
I know there's some fresh things and some healthier snack kind of things, but and I've seen them several times. Like I just can't.
They're also reliant on the local food pantries, right?
Yeah.
They do. They do, but I think I don't know exactly what the logistics are of it, but it is definitely more robust than it was before, and I think that they're being a little
more. Well, we did it was the first year, I think, so I'm very happy to hear that.
Yeah.
Food sounds like it's a lot better than it was.
Any other questions?
Yeah, two questions. Do you know why the college and the wellness fairs are both on the same?
I think the idea, and Matt, you may know better than me, I think the idea was that they wanted to combine those into one so that parents would have, and students would have access to the resources all in one night. Like, it's all the same fair.
Because the college fair attracts the junior, senior families. But the wellness fair, I thought, attracted the younger families.
We already had the
elementary one.
Yeah, the Family Fitness Fun Night
is
the younger thing. Is that what you're talking about?
Well, no, I thought the wellness night was for younger.
The Family Fitness Night was for K through 8 families, but along with fitness, they had all kinds of different like wellness activities and vendors and healthy snack contests and whatnot. So,
so vendors that are not attracting, like for example, Nuvance, which is the new health class, they wanted to reserve a table so they could talk about child car seats, but they shouldn't come because it's not the crowd, right?
No.
No, they shouldn't come, or no, they should come?
I don't, I mean, I think it would be better to talk to the organizers, but my first impression is no, that it, that wouldn't be for that.
It's more for
high school. This is more for high schoolers. This is like mental health, you know, physical health, like that kind of stuff, plus college information. Does
okay,
that make sense?
Because that wasn't on the flyer that was being sent out to people, to vendors. And I think, I believe then that's why it's being confused.
What time is that college fair for?
Well, I'm looking at it. I'm looking for it right now. Give me
what we can do is we'll just have, since I know Ms. Tansy's out, we'll have, I'll talk to John Giametta about it.
Yeah.
I don't think we need to
deliver
it. No, I'm not trying to deliver it. I just, you know, somebody in the community who said, we'll listen. I'm like, okay. And then now I'm finding out that maybe they shouldn't go. But.
I'm going to look at the calendar.
Willis?
I just wanted to say that the deadline to register for the March SAT is this Friday, February 14th, which leads me to a request for a future discussion, actually. I'd just like to understand how college entrance exams are communicated as far as scheduling, registering in our district, because I, as the parent of a junior, have not received any direct communication about the SAT. And I had spoken with Ms. Soto about this last year, and she told me that she had plans for better communications around these things. But as yet, I haven't really seen it, and I just want to understand from an equity perspective, are all students being notified, and are their families being notified of college entrance exams? Meredith, you have a junior, don't you?
I have a sophomore.
You have a sophomore.
But I do think that that's a, it's important to make sure that that information is going out to everyone.
Yeah, I mean, I'm curious. I mean, my son is not an honor student. It makes me wonder, well, are the honor students getting that communication and not my kid? I want to make sure that every kid is getting a note home or an email or a text or a robocall that register your child for the SAT. Last year when my son was a sophomore, we completely missed the opportunity for the PSAT because I didn't know when it was offered and I had gotten no information. So it's something that I think is important that we should discuss at some point.
I agree, it needs a bit more attention and publicity.
Every kid should have the opportunity. But if mom and dad don't know that it's happening, I know my kid doesn't come home and tell me everything that he was told while he was at school.
Yeah,
so.
They're not jumping up and down to the SATs.
Also funding, how to get access to the TAP program, how to get loans, how to do all that stuff should be.
I'll put it on at the next board meeting.
Great. I think that kind of, those kinds of things are
communicated
well.
Yeah, they have like a whole night of
But as far as like, when is the test being offered? Where is it being offered?
It's those more logistical things.
That kind of thing.
Yeah.
I know that for the PSAT, it's offered on a Saturday. So students have to get there.
That's
whereas
only true.
In other districts,
yeah.
Like down in New Jersey where I used to live, the PSAT is taken during school hours in the morning, and I know that from talking with a teacher friend of mine in down there, every sophomore in the Wayne Valley High School, every sophomore took the PSAT because they weren't really given a choice about it. It was like, this is what we're doing and everyone's going to do it. Whereas talking to my son's friends' parents here, not one of them took the PSAT, and none of them even knew when it was. So that concerns me.
Next meeting we'll talk about
it? Yeah, we'll go on. I have it down.
Thank you.
Mike?
Well, Craig kind of gave the highlights of the Facilities and Operations Committee, but I will say it was good to hear from the architects that they're really engaged and energized. You've been talking about holding multiple meetings. in order to get up to speed, because if you think of it, the building condition survey has got to be done, and we're looking at putting a plan together for voting
this December.
So it's pretty quick. So but they're energized, and we got the strategic plan, so it's going to be I think it's going to be good. That's all I had.
Great. Any questions for Mike? Anthony?
Good evening. I apologize. I missed quite a few meetings last week. I missed the policy committee meeting. I missed the district-wide emergency team meeting as well. I was working in Puerto Rico that week, so I do apologize for that. The next diversity committee meeting is on February 10th. I'm sorry. This is February 10th. On it's March. February 20th, so if the district-wide emergency team meeting was on the 5th, does that mean February is going to get skipped, or I mean you're still going to have it on the 19th?
We're going to change it off that time.
Change the 19th.
Okay. We're just going to go to the March date.
Gotcha. All right.
Which is March 18th.
Okay. Thank you. And thank you to Anthony and Ron for their presentations. I also support the industrial composter with the curriculum that goes with it. And I do have some items that I'd like to bring up in that discussion for consensus as well. The styrofoam stuff, I'm glad to hear that it's been eliminated from lunchrooms, but I kind of think we're still using them throughout the district, I believe. I mean, we just had some little styrofoam plates with the cookies there. So, is that being phased out?
So what's your question?
Is that being phased out?
Use of styrofoam?
Yeah, throughout the district, or is it just in the lunchroom?
I don't know where the place for the cookies came from, but I think the goal is to phase it out.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, according to Karen Pagano, we're not using it. At least not in the lunchrooms.
The stadium appraisal, do we know what the status is on that?
They requested some information from us just a week or two ago, and we sent it right out to them, so I think they're working on it. I don't have an exact deadline for when they're going to be done, but
and
it's happening.
Okay. And the smart bond application to Assemblyman Jacobson?
Cool. We can mention it in our meeting on Tuesday.
Okay.
Not tomorrow, Tuesday.
A week from Tuesday.
You're meeting with Assemblyman Jacobson?
Correct.
Okay. All right. That's all I have. Thank you very much.
Okay. Any questions for Anthony? Meredith. Hold up 1 second. They were all taken care of then. All your questions were taken care of?
Yes.
Okay.
Matt, I wonder if you could share with us the dates of the PTO meetings so that we could try to attend one or two, because I do think that's a really helpful part of the budget development. I guess we can just look on the web. Is it on the website or?
It's in my blog, and I sent it to the board
blog.
As well.
Okay, I'll look there. And I wanted to congratulate Anthony on doing his super eval for the board. Still a few to go.
So
not naming any names because I can't.
Who hasn't done it besides me?
Actually, if you log in, you can see who hasn't done it.
True.
You're not alone.
As soon as I charge this laptop,
I do want to apologize. I thought that was a group email in that system, and I sent it, I guess, individually to everyone that I did it.
Oh.
I didn't mean to do that.
You were looking for individual praise, that's why.
No, I wasn't.
So I did spend the day in Albany yesterday and this morning at the NISMA conference, Capital Conference, that basically goes over the governor's proposed budget in some detail. But just to give the highlights, everyone has heard it's $826 million increase. it is less than half of what NISBA and the Regents have proposed. And it was very interesting because we heard from the NISBA people and then we heard from the governor's office, and it was, you know, just a completely different point of view. There is an increase in foundation aid, but it still doesn't come close to what we would be owed in foundation aid. And the more frightening thing about it is that all of these expense-based aids are being consolidated into the foundation aid, and it's kind of, from the way the governor's office was talking about it, it was like, you get it this year, and then you just maybe don't get it at all. It was very much like, we're giving you a year to prepare for this, which I'm not sure how we would prepare for that. It would be pretty devastating. One of the, there are 10 different aids that they're consolidating or proposing to consolidate, and one of them is BOCES aid, which would really be devastating to BOCES. And I think we're constantly thinking about how to get around BOCES, but I think we actually need to value BOCES right now, because it really is kind of threatened as a service, and if we didn't have it, there's no way we could make up for what it offers us. So I think it's a good moment to just value it rather than figure out how to not deal with it. The other kind of scary part is the building aid and transportation aid changes, which, you know, would all be reduced. And it sounded like they would impact wealthier districts more than poor districts, but I think there would be impact across the board. The good news is that it's just the proposal. It usually goes up from here. We heard Shelley Mayer, the state senator, and I think she's the chair of the education committee, said that they were fighting hard for more. So I'm sure it will go up a little bit from here, but we don't know exactly how much. And we want to share this with Jonathan Jacobson. So I spoke with Julie Shiro Ishii, and we will be meeting with him a week from Tuesday. So we'll let you know how that goes. And there were some election things that came up. One actually was good, that we are, a bill did pass where we are not on the hook to have the early voting at schools. So that was good news. Time off for voting is still an issue. I'm just trying to give a little bit more good news here. There is a vaping proposal that basically bans all flavored vaping products that Cuomo put out, which would be a really good start, barring just banning it altogether. So, but there was a lot of talk about how, if marijuana was legalized, how that would complicate the whole vaping situation. So it was very interesting. I'm glad I went.
Any questions for Meredith? Great job, Meredith. Thank you for going. I have no comments, but there was a request for textbook lists with syllabi. So I know you guys started that conversation, so I just wanted to continue it since everybody's done with the board comments. The only question I had is, I know Meredith was saying, you know, about, and Matt was saying about trust. What else would you want? Like, there's a course description for each course offered at the high school. That's pretty, it gives a description, it gives like the title, how many semesters to credit, if there's a prerequisite, and then it gives a description as to the course.
Yes, me?
Yeah.
I'm curious, you have course descriptions. But do our teachers write their own course descriptions? Or are those written by curriculum committee?
No.
I mean, it's like either the individual or the department.
Individual or department. I mean, just in my experience, when I write syllabi, like, I don't write the course description. It's just put in the catalog. Oftentimes, multiple teachers teach the exact same course, and they all teach it very differently. I don't know on the high school level. I mean, actually, I think that kind of variety is fine. It's great. What the syllabi shows you is what are the, a little bit more granular, like what are the specific, not maybe not textbooks, but maybe what are the novels they're reading? What are some of the ways it's being talked about? And something that I think is interesting to me on the on a board level is, while a teacher knows their syllabi, they don't necessarily know how that, they may or may not know how that is fitting with, you know, let's say how a literature course is fitting with social studies or, you know, the different, or in sciences, kind of how all these sort of bigger pictures. And that's kind of my general curiosity.
I have a question with that. So I've been listening, really trying to listen and understand, and I think of our swim lane chart. So, you know, I hear you say you're interested. I'm just wondering, is that in our swim lane? Of something that is for us to consider or to make requirements out of. I'm just still struggling a little bit with it.
I mean, I'm just reading like the AP English Literature and Composition, and it does have the novels, it has the study of the drama, including plays.
Why did you send this link to James?
It's right on our website.
I know, but could you forward him the link?
Yeah.
I mean, to me, it would be helpful, and it would be illuminating. But if you know, it's
all right. So, does the board want the textbooks and syllabi list?
I think if we could separate it out between textbooks and syllabus.
I mean, maybe it'd be helpful for the conversation to know reasons against why we would not want to be able to see that. Because it's not. I mean, it's not a hill I'm going to die on.
I think Matt expressed it pretty well that there is the potential to feel that the board is overstepping and it's not trusting.
I think it's a micromanagement piece. It's not our, we're not.
I wonder if there'd be a way to put blinders on it in some way, either like remove teachers' names from it. You know, I certainly don't need to see that. If we could establish that we will not be giving direct comment or feedback on any of this, is it something I don't think we should have any interest in doing? One of the things that actually brought this up was the ease at which it seems like all that information is just there. I'm really aware, I'm very aware, I think we all are, of the history of trust, you know, and how we can rebuild some of that trust. And I wonder if this is an opportunity to rebuild some trust. You know, just sort of saying we will never, ever ask any questions or ever have curiosity about what you're teaching. You know, I don't know if that's necessarily.
But as a parent, I may ask those questions.
Yeah.
So to say I'd never ask questions, that wouldn't be true.
Well, I mean, if I only ask about, you know, my sons are in sixth grade, you know, but I'm curious about, you know, I feel like it falls under our purview as a board to have curiosity about what's happening.
I mean, if I can weigh in a little bit, I can appreciate the trust in the conversation. I mean, if we just straight out say, hey, the board wants to look at this list of books, and all of a sudden, you know, either folks may get quite a few reactions on both sides of the spectrum, like, yeah, sure, yeah, I'd love for them to be interested in what we're doing, or why are they really asking? But this is not private information. I mean, like you said, Anthony, that's information shared with the parents and the students. I mean, I've seen questions on Facebook. It's like, well, what are they, you know, what are they doing in that class, or you know, what is this? You know, parents will answer. It's not exactly private information. I guess what I'm trying to point out is that, you know, at this public meeting, we're asking. And if it's not given, it does seem a little suspicious of why a list couldn't be compiled. Again,
I think they're mix and mingling individual requests that a person may have and then a board making a request. There's a difference between a person making a request and then an acting authority as the board making a request for that information. And that's a concern to me, that this board is not, we approve the purchase of textbooks and create policies on textbooks, but to grab a syllabi, whereas a parent, it's given to me when my child is in that course, I get that piece, like as a parent. But for an acting body, a unit of nine that oversees the operations of the district, but we're not managing the district, that's Matt's job, to ask for that, that's a concern. For my part, as a whole body, to do that.
Do we feel like this falls under? I'm just going to read a quote from a policy we're approving or looking at tonight. The board will periodically request the superintendent to present information necessary to evaluate the effectiveness of the school system. Evaluation may address the extent to which The total learning environment, including instructional processes, physical facilities, and the educational program, remain consistent with the needs of the students, and the larger society contributes to the accomplishment of the goals of the school. I'm just curious if us asking specific questions about the nature of the courses and the curriculum falls under providing the information necessary to evaluate as per our policy.
I think that you could get 9 different perspectives on that piece.
I would love to hear those, 8 of those.
So
I'll give my perspective. I'm not real comfy with asking to see this individual syllabus from the different teachers. Maybe the answer is how we frame the question. The way we invite the like facilities and transportation to come and present what they're doing this year or what their plans are, maybe why not invite the department heads? I assume we have department chairs in the high school for different subject areas. Would they be more open to an invitation to come and talk to us about what's new and exciting in teaching history in the high school and telling us about what kids can expect to learn? Would frame it more around a overview rather than looking at the individual syllabus. I mean, in the high school, in the fall, when your child starts a class, the syllabus comes home and parents have to read it and sign off on it and send it back. So, and I've seen lots of high school syllabus and I've always been pretty impressed. I've never, questioned anything. But I do feel like there's a point of contention when the school board is asking the teachers to submit. I don't feel like that's really...
But they submit them to Matt.
Elisa.
To the principal.
To the principal.
Yeah. So they are submitting their syllabi publicly.
But, and you said that you submit your syllabus to your chair, but your chair doesn't pass it on
to the board of directors.
President of the college.
Right.
But dean, certainly. Yeah.
To the president of the college?
Not the president of the college, but...
Well, that's
if
like...
If the president of the college asked, they certainly could.
Right, but that's like...
But how would that make you feel?
I wouldn't care. I mean, this is also part of it. I don't think that... As long as nobody comes back and says, you need to change this, it's honestly like... I mean, if I would love to have people... I mean, I always love when people come and give these presentations, but I almost feel like that's a much bigger ask to ask someone to... department head to come stand before us and tell us everything that's going on with us questions. It's a bigger ask than just forwarding us.
And I wouldn't be in favor of that as well. I would have the principal do that piece.
Yeah.
That would be an administrative piece, I think, more so than a department chair. Doing it, they get that information from the people and coming
through. However it's done. I mean, maybe it's just
an
event at the school, even, at the high school, where, I mean, Elisa has done a few different programs this school year, like an evening program of like when they had the clubs, all the clubs came out and talked about, you could go and find out everything there is to know about clubs in the high school. There's different ways that we could get a perspective on what's being taught.
Sure.
I think.
I guess this is just me, and so it makes sense that maybe I'm not the majority, but if I could just say, I mean, I think that it's, I'm not coming from this from the perspective that it's necessarily something, an area of distrust or it has to be scrutinizing, but actually about celebrating and having curiosity and being excited about the specific things that are being taught in our schools.
Right. It's all about perspective, though.
Yeah, it reads like we're doing a blanket assessment.
Yeah. And the course descriptions are there to get excited about. And I mean, I think that if you read a course description and had questions about it, that would be one thing, but the idea of this sort of like data dump it doesn't feel good to me.
Okay.
So one of the super eval questions is, the board actively generates support for the district through its vision and promoting educational opportunities for all their students. And the board, goes through noteworthy evidence of it. So, I mean, how can we?
Well, that's where I think the curriculum mapping is really, could be very exciting. We're trying to line it up with the strategic plan and the characteristics and attributions that we were looking for in a Beacon graduate, but we're using data. We're trying to kind of find all of these different facets and how they fit together to make that whole student that we're trying to nurture and move through the system. So.
So is that going to be a workshop?
Yeah, I think that would be a great workshop.
I think that needs to be proposed to the board, but we'll have to propose it at the next time you have board comments.
So we separated the two.
Wait,
syllabus and textbook.
You already had your board comments.
No, you said we were going to get consensus after the board comments.
We're talking about textbook right now and the textbook list and the syllabi.
Yes.
You just brought up about another workshop.
There's no other items.
We're still on that conversation.
Oh yeah, so then I said I had conversations for that consensus part.
So, but then you mentioned a workshop.
Yeah, I can bring it up for my consensus part. But
so, can we stay on the topic because it's
yes, we can.
10:10.
Just don't.
So, for the textbook, is there any request for the textbooks? Raise your hand.
I'm in favor of what he wants to do because I don't see any reason why we should discourage any member of this board who wants access to anything that's public information. If you don't want to read it, you don't have to look at it.
So
I mean, how hard could it be to produce it? I mean, it's there someplace, right?
Is there a policy requirement for us to review textbook lists?
Yes.
Every 6 years.
We have oversight to the whole district, so.
Well, that's a general term, so was there specifically a policy?
The way the policy is written is it says we will review textbooks every 5 years.
Six, right?
We just changed it, yeah. We just changed it to six, though.
So we should be doing something.
I guess we need to see on that.
Yep.
When was the last time we did them? Reviewed them,
that's interesting.
They get reviewed at different times, but.
It's on a rolling, kind of a rolling basis.
Just to uphold.
I think it was on the new agenda. It's a new policy. It's a first read.
Well, no, the one that's on first read doesn't have that edit.
It occurs as the licenses
from
the textbooks expire.
Oh, no, it is. It says
the board.
It's a first read for one.
That's how the policy reads, but how it's done is based on the rules.
So textbooks, am I hearing yes to textbooks?
Yes.
Raise your hand if you want to review
I'd
the
like
textbooks
to see
list.
Those.
Sounds like it.
Okay. Okay, so textbooks, yes. Syllabi, raise your hand if you want to review the syllabi.
No.
Okay.
Not yet.
Meredith made a request for timeline for curriculum maps. Does the board want to make requests to have Matt?
Can we, it would make sense to do that. That's already happening in curriculum committee.
Yeah, I didn't
like,
mean
I don't
want
to.
That
oh, yeah, yeah.
Yeah,
oh.
I think that's a conversation that is happening currently in the curriculum.
Sorry. Anthony, what were you saying? About
well,
a workshop?
No, it was similar to that.
Our next meeting is on February 19th, and I will come back with more information about, like, because we really don't have a timeline for that yet, so is that okay?
Yeah, that's fine. Yes. And being sensitive to the budget schedule, you know, I don't want to bog down everybody on this. I do know that once May comes, and then everybody breathes a sigh of relief, and then everybody's going to graduate and finish up the thing. Sometimes some of these things kind of fall to the side, but for the PPS report that's coming, I did want to ask whether is there a way to compare it PPS with families who are with more means versus less means. There was an article in the USA Today about private placement, but you know more broadly. Folks with less means may not be aware of the opportunities that are available to them versus families with more means. Can the PPS presentation maybe either include or just mention that these are the data points that we need to be collected if we were going to do something like that.
I think the easy data point is just you can sort of. I don't know the right phrase, but kind of cross students who qualify for free and reduced lunch with students who have an IEP. I did somewhere between skim and read the article, and it gets at a very complex thing that I think it's a hard, at least my read of it is, it's not this data point that's just sort of sitting there readily.
Yes.
It's complicated and I don't actually know where we would start to assess that. But we can start by looking at students, you know, who qualify for IEPs, students who receive free and reduced lunch, and just kind of look there. That's not really what the article's getting at, but
so
I don't know where to begin to do that study.
But that's an individual request that he's making.
I'm sorry, yeah.
So let's see if the board would like to have our administration look into the request about wealthier families being more apt to be classified than our lower income families.
It wasn't apt to be classified, it was apt to receive private placements, I think.
Yeah, the article's about private placement, but in general, because of the resources available to families that have more resources, they are more apt to get be able to tap into networks or something that would help them advocate or whatever resources for their children versus lower income, which may not even have enough have any resources or networks that would help them advocate for resources for their children. So it's an equity question, and I'm sensitive to the fact that it's may not be something that we collect traditionally, but it is something that I think maybe a conversation of how something like that could be looked at to make sure we're not disenfranchising families that have less resources.
So what I would say is I'm not opposed to it wholeheartedly. I'm opposed to having our district staff do it. There are companies that contract out and do audits of our departments, particularly special ed departments, that could do an audit of that department to see how they're coming up with decisions at their CSE meetings to make sure that it's equitable and that they're following the proper process. So there's companies such as, I think it's Futures, Marble just went through it with a company, I could get the name, but that would be something where I'd say I wouldn't want to waste our district, I'd rather have our district administrators in the district working on servicing and providing services to kids instead of figuring out. That would be an extensive search process, and I think that would be something that would be should be contracted out because it would be looked through with a less biased eyes. So if you were to do something like that, I would say go that route instead of asking our administrators to look at it.
I think I'd like to hear more about that.
I could put it on for a future board discussion if you want, and then I could give some information, and then because I didn't pre-discuss that with anybody here, but so they're knowledgeable about what I'm talking about as well. Is that all right?
That sounds great. Would you be willing to send that to the whole board, if you have any
information
about
I'll scan it in.
Those people, yeah.
Great, I mean, that's just one company. There's many companies that do it, so.
And the other thing was, I mentioned to Andy the model about the stormwater collection and stuff. Is that something that we need to have a study for, or is that something that just...
So, pose it as a question as to, I'm asking Matt to do this, so I think we have a better understanding as to what you're asking.
As a question? I feel like I'm in jeopardy.
I would like Matt to... Or I would like to know.
I would like the school district to do an analysis on collecting stormwater to feed our gardens and conserve drinking water.
Okay.
Do you think that, I do feel like the new architecture firm is very well positioned to be thinking about that, thinking about more than that actually in the work that they're doing. So I don't know if we need to be that specific. I think they understand that we have that interest and that, that it's one of our goals. So I have a feeling, what I would say is maybe hold that thought and see if any of it comes back in their plans. And then, if it's not there, ask then.
How would I know?
They're doing the building. I mean, Mike, maybe you can speak to this a little bit more specifically, but they'll be doing the building survey and then coming back with things that have to be done. But if there's something that has to be done, it's like with the roof, and they're, I think they seem like the type of people that will say, you know, while you're doing the roof, you might want to do this stormwater collection thing. It's not that expensive. You're going to be, you know, ripping it up anyway or something like that. That's sort of how they explain their process to us in the interview.
And I would request that it go to the facilities committee first to have the discussion there before it gets to the board meeting.
I think we'll probably do that.
I mean, is it since we're here talking about it, I mean, can we just establish that who on the board has an interest in a gray water system? Just say that's something that's interesting.
Gray water is different than stormwater.
Is it different?
Yeah. Gray water is...
See, this is why it's morphing, and I think it should go to facilities first, so that's my opinion.
I support that.
Yeah, I support it.
Okay.
I'd like to see curriculum added to that too, though.
Alrighty. You're done with your questions. Alright, moving on to the next agenda, new business. We have, Goli Sanford, letter of interest to be, to serve on the Dutchess, BOCES school board. We do have a Beacon representative on the board already. His name is...
Michael Reel.
Michael Reel.
Is he up for election?
No. And it's typical, they sent a letter out on January 24th where all board members had a chance to review it. There's three open seats. Just because we do have a representative doesn't mean that we can't nominate one, but they do try to keep it equitable throughout the component districts. So we have a letter for Goli Sanford.
Anthony?
Yes.
Why did you mention Beacon resident? I mean, Goli's from, not from Beacon.
No, I was just saying that we have someone from Beacon that is already on the Dutchess BOCES board.
Oh.
Which I think means we couldn't have another one.
It doesn't mean that we couldn't have another one, but it means that if you wanted to go serve on the Dutchess BOCES board, they try to divide it up amongst the component districts in the county to serve on there. So they did, I think in their letter, they did a...
In reference to Beacon guy, yeah.
Yeah.
He'll be up for election, re-election.
Right, so I was just pointing that out as a frame of reference to know that there is someone that used to, that's from Beacon on the Dutchess BOCES board.
And these are the only three that we know of, right?
Yes.
Are we making a decision then?
Well, we have to send it in before March 1st.
Before,
right?
March 1st, yeah. So
we only have one more board meeting, I guess, if we were not to do this tonight, right?
Correct. I mean, we could put it off, but it's something that I wanted to make sure that we pointed out. So that you could think, if you need to do your research, do your own little research, and then you can make an informed decision. Okay? And I just also wanted to point out that April 1st, Dutchess BOCES is having an annual budget meeting and community open house. So if you have questions about the budget, I think this would be very informative for you to see, because it's about school board budgets and stuff. So it's something that's useful, and it's a little expo, so.
Wait, is that training, or is that the BOCES?
It's not a training, it's a CTI Spring Expo, and it's about the annual budget that Dutchess BOCES is putting on.
Okay.
Just an FYI. Any questions, any comments about the elections? So at the next meeting, you're going to see that we're going to need to vote. So we'll go from discussion to vote.
If anyone has any information on that that will be helpful, if you could send it. Can you do research somebody and have an opinion?
I mean, literally, it's usually like the letter from the person, and that's kind of
that's where we
have to go.
Yeah. Do your Facebook
good
digging.
Background. Something's resume.
Go on your little Facebook and dig them up, you know?
Yeah.
All right.
So just for clarity.
The use of the consent agenda permits the Board of Education make more effective use of its time by adopting a single motion to cover those relatively routine matters which are included. Any member of the board who wishes to discuss individually a particular piece of business on the consent agenda may so indicate, and the item will be considered and voted on separately, thus preserving the right of all board members to be heard on any issues. Any member of the board like any item pulled?
11.16.
Hearing no other items, I need a motion to approve 11.01 through 11.22 minus 11.16.
So moved.
Second.
Comments or questions?
I would just comment. 11.08,
I was going to.
Are you all right? Go ahead.
No, go ahead.
11.08, accepting donations. Donations are very powerful, so it is the right thing to do to give thanks. So $959 from Entergy Government and Regulatory Affairs for saltwater tank maintenance. $2,928.65 from the Italian American Committee on Education for the purchase of books for the Italian Club. I'm assuming that it continues.
The Wii.
Nintendo Wii gaming console and accessories from Mrs. Patricia Zablinas. I hope I said that correctly. For the ADL PE class at Rombaugh Middle School. So,
if you're all questioning about the Wii with PE, the ADL kids love it because they're doing the movement and they have, it's absolutely awesome. It's very cool to participate with them in it, and it's awesome. So, like, I was like, yes, they got the Wii. So
much appreciated.
Absolutely. Said my comment. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed? Motion carried. 8-0. I need a motion for 11.16.
So moved.
Second.
Comments or questions?
So, it's just a mistake we missed. So we changed the period from 5 years to 6 years to be more in line with the contracts that we have. So under number one, it did get changed to this period of 6 years. But if you go to the second paragraph, it still says text once approved by the board shall not be superseded for a period of 5 years. I believe that should be six to be in line with the following criteria.
And that definitely was accurate as
yes.
to what the board was discussing at the policy committee was discussing to change it to a 6 year. So if you guys are fine, we could adopt the first read as amended, and then we could do the second read and make sure that it's corrected to 6 years.
So motion to amend that motion of 11.6 to change that text to 6 years from five.
All yes. right.
Second.
Okay, so I need a motion now to approve 11.16 as amended. Oh, all those in favor?
Aye.
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 That's 8-0. Opposed? Great. So now I need a motion for 11.16 as amended.
Motion.
Oh, the motion was already granted by James and it was seconded by Anthony. Any other comments or questions? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? 8-0. Any motion to adjourn the meeting?
Motion to adjourn.
James second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion granted.
I don't want to end. I don't want to end.